I'm gonna call this meeting of the CPDC to order. We are gonna take something out of order first and just discuss some signage or some window treatments. And then we'll move on to site plan review for Meadowbrook and then subdivision plan review for Garden Estates. If you haven't already signed in, please make sure you do so, so that we have your name for the record. And if you choose to speak when we do public comments, please make sure you state your name and your address for the record. Thank you. Also, given that I think both of these hearings later on are, won't be completed tonight, we'll stick to the agenda timeline of about an hour for each one, since they'll be continued to another meeting. All right, Julie, what do we have for?
So we have Brett and Linda here on behalf of 54 Haven PDA Dental, to talk to you about some options for frosted glass or window treatments for their dental office space, which is on the first floor.
Okay.
Hi, everybody. Just proud to say that we just finished a beautiful build-out, 54 Haven Street, the old Portland Pizza residence. So we have occupancy, which Kim finally issued us after a few reports, but everything is looking great. They're planning on opening next week, next Monday, the 21st. They're just moving from your current Reading location. So currently we have 13 exterior windows on Haven Street, as well as on the side, which is the rear entrance to the back parking lot. What we're looking to do is do a window application only on the lower section in line eyesight of patients. We are not trying to cover up the waiting room areas. We are only trying to put this application in for patient privacy. We have to meet HIPAA guidelines here. Many of the chairs, all the toes of the chairs face the exterior with windows, ground level. If somebody is in a skirt, people outside have a clear view. So this is really for the patient privacy. We tried to find an application that would allow a lot of light through. We don't want to put blinds up. We don't want to put shades and block everything. So we're trying to find, and our architect came up with, is a 3M application. It goes on the inside of the window. It is easily removable in case we want to change it, or if they ever moved out. I don't see moving out anytime soon, but it is easily removable. So I think there are a couple pictures in there showing the storefront. This is just a stock photo here, kind of giving you an idea of the amount of light and what somebody inside will be able to see out, and likewise. So when you're looking in, here's some applications that we've done on other dental offices. So as you can still see through it. There's still some light. However, it is giving the patients their privacy. So that's the view from 54 Haven. So we have the bottom windows here. We also have the top windows. This white area is only a representation. It's not actually the 3M material, just showing where we would put the application going across. Top transoms would remain clear. The top belt foot area, 16 inches clear as well. We're playing around with the idea of leaving the bottom 4 or 5 inches clear as well. So, but literally we have 5 chairs in here, all facing the exterior. Same is true along the side of the building.
Are you proposing any graphics or signage integrated into it, or separate from it?
You know what, I'm only the general contractor, so I've been working with them for 6-7 months, so when it comes to graphics, it's not my thing. That is up to them. I think it's, right now, I think the goal is simply to get on a solid application. Graphics can be applied, signage can be applied later. Obviously, we understand we'd have to go through the same process again. But for the time being, I think the goal is to get this up so they can open on Mondays. Graphics can always be cut into the current application as well.
Yeah, I don't object to what you're proposing. If you do signage, you'll have to comply with the size, the rest of the signage. I don't think that if they were to put it on the top portion of this entire panel, it's not like a signboard. It's literally just the letter size in a window. So if you were proposing a signboard that was 5 feet tall, about 5 feet, the entire thing counts as your sign size.
Right.
Whereas for a window, it's really just a letter size.
Right.
Yeah, we count the letters and the graphics, the window signage. So it's, I think it would depend if they wanted to come back, just to let us make sure that it conforms. It's a little tricky in the window signage section.
Is that regarding lettering or logos, or, yeah?
Yeah, you can just have them circle back to us, and we'll work with you so you get it right.
Yeah, that's fine. We talked about this. This is one of the reasons we don't like these kind of uses on the ground floors, because you sort of shut off that streetscape. But we understand you're in there, you need to make it work.
Right. So we're trying to find something that's a happy medium for everybody.
Yeah. What information do you have from 3M on the durability, ColorFast?
It's on the interior of the window, so it's not open to any of the elements. As to the wear and tear, I mean, it's a 3M product. I'm not sure what the warranties are, but what are your main concerns?
UV blocker?
Yeah, it's UV
or
stable.
UV stable?
We've used it before. I've used it on applications before. You can actually use it in fluoride runs, so it won't touch the glass.
Okay.
Fluoride, it's sort of sacrificial for fluoride, so it is probably pretty easy.
Yeah. Okay.
Any other questions, or? Thank you.
Okay. Easy. All right, next we have a public hearing, site plan review, and special permit for 292 Grove Street, Meadowbrook Golf Club. Do we have a notice for this?
Yeah, it was on top.
Notice is hereby given that pursuant to sections 4.3 and 4.6 of the Town of Reading zoning bylaw, in accordance with MGL Chapter 48, Section 9, the Community Planning and Development Commission will hold a public hearing on Monday, August 14th, 2017 at 7:30 p.m. in this meeting room at Reading Town Hall, 16 Lowell Street, to consider the application for a site plan review to construct a new clubhouse and make associated site improvements, and for a special permit to continue the pre-existing non-conforming private club use submitted by Meadowbrook Golf Club for land located at 292 or 288 Grove Street, Assessor's Map 37, Lot 4, in Reading, Mass. A copy of the application and associated plans are available to the public in the Public Services Department in Town Hall on Monday, Wednesday, Thursday from 7:30 to 5:30, and on Tuesday, 7:30 to 7 p.m.
Okay, so we'll hear from the applicant, from staff and the board, and then we'll take public comments. Julie, did you want to start with anything, or just kick it over to them?
Start with Jack.
Okay.
Thank you very much for taking the time. I just want to quickly go through an opening statement, and then I'll turn it over to our team members. I want to introduce them really quick. Jack Sullivan, who was the project engineer on this, Andrew Weaver, our project architect, Bob Morelli, our club manager up at Meadowbrook, Darrell Carter from Stateside, the project construction group, and Rich Bover, who's a member, resident, and project advisor to the board. By way of introductions, I'm the president of Meadowbrook Golf Club. I've been a member there for about 35 years plus, and I'm in my first year of tenure. I've been on the board for the last 11 years of Meadowbrook, so just by way of introductions. I'll read a short opening statement. I'm going to follow along kind of what we've submitted so far, and then I'll turn it over to Jack and to Andrew to go into a little bit more detail on the plans that we've submitted, if that's okay for everybody. For over 100 years, Meadowbrook Golf Club has been in existence, serving the community of Greater Reading area, providing challenging and rewarding golf, pool, and tennis for its members. It's had a long tradition as being one of the appealing and challenging golf layouts in the area. An important part of the club is our over 70-year-old clubhouse. It has hosted many club events, provided food and social spots for all of our members, and has played a major role in our fundraising initiatives throughout the years. Over the past several years, the board, along with its membership, has been evaluating the current structure of the building along with a view towards long-term needs. We have leveraged the expertise of many members in the building and construction area along with paid professionals in evaluating our options. The board and the membership believe it's time to build a new clubhouse to address many of the interests of our evolving membership. We're excited about the current plan and look forward to it serving the membership and the larger community of Reading. In developing this option, the board and its advisors followed some very important guiding principles. Basically, membership of the club will largely stay same as we see it today and for the foreseeable future. We are a 9-hole course with pool and tennis membership. We want a building that supports the evolving demographics of the membership and designed it for our current social and function activity. We do not expect that to change as we go forward. We believe the new clubhouse, which will sit in mostly the same space as it does today, meets all of these requirements. We're excited about this proposal and look forward to working closely with the town of Reading as we have throughout the years. In accordance with the criteria from the Community and Planning and Development Commission, we submit the following for your review. A traffic study that was submitted, the proposed use of the property will remain basically the same as the existing building is being replaced with a new building of approximately equal size. The new clubhouse will serve to the function in the same manner as the existing clubhouse with no expansion of functions or membership. Therefore, the traffic patterns on site and traffic generated to and from the club will remain consistent with what it is today. The addition of a separate loading area and trash recycling area will improve vehicular safety since these larger vehicles will now be separated from the passenger vehicles to the on-site area. In addition, the preparation for a photometric plan. This applicant is unique in the parcel lot of size of 60 acres. The property across the street of the golf course is under common ownership. There are no direct residential abutters that would be affected by the lighting. Cut sheets have been provided provided of the building lighting and siting plans for the project, and the site plan shows all the exterior light, site lighting, and the architectural plan shows the building lighting as well. And then we're also asking for a special permit. The owner and applicant is seeking a special permit for a pre-existing non-conforming use in an S20, S40 zoning district. The use would continue to be a multi-purpose recreational facility as it is today. And I'll finish there. And Jack, I'll ask you.
Thank you. For the record, my name is Jack Sullivan, owner of the Sullivan Engineering Group. And I just wanted to give the board some history of first time we're coming before you, but we have been in front of the town and we've been in front of another board, so I want to bring you up to speed. Early on in this project design, we met with Julie, just to kind of give her a heads up that this would be coming the town's way, and kind of had a good conversation with her, showed her some rough schematics of what we were looking to do. She recommended we get him to a greater design level and come to a development review team meeting, which we did. So we did have a development review team meeting. From that meeting, we further increased our design. We added all the finished site grading, drainage, landscaping. At that time, since we had made so many improvements, Julie thought it would be a good idea if we had a second DRT meeting, which we did. And we received town comments from that DRT meeting. Last week, we went before the Conservation Commission. A portion of this project falls within 100 feet of a wetland resource area, not the building itself. But when I go through my presentation, you'll see we're removing some pavement. I'm going to put in a rain garden. And we're doing some landscaping features that do fall within 100 feet of a wetland area. So we filed a request for determination of applicability with the Conservation Commission. We met last week. We had a good meeting. I did tell them we did continue that hearing, knowing we'd be coming before you. And following this hearing, we're hoping to finish up the plans, get back before them and back before you for hopefully a positive decision on this project. And also, there was a neighborhood outreach meeting a few weeks ago. The club put out notice to the abutters that they, if they had any questions or wanted to see the project, they could come in, meet. So they met a few weeks ago on that. And, okay, Julie, do you have the existing conditions plan, Julie?
Yep.
Stated, we're basically looking to demolish the existing club, construct a new club in generally the same location. One thing that I should point out that may play into the special permit granting authority of this board is this existing corner is about 14 feet off the right-of-way. So the front yard setback in the S-20 district is 20 feet, and the new club is going to be 34 feet from the right-of-way. So we're moving the building a little further back, but in doing so, that makes it more conforming to zoning. So I wanted to point it out. The new club will also, it meets all dimensional requirements, building setbacks, building height, lot coverage. It is within the aquifer protection district. It's a 60-acre site, though, so there's not that much impervious area on that 60 acres. I did want to point this out as well. There's an existing curb cut here that the club membership uses for access and egress. And also, this is the edge of pavement out on the street. There's a retaining wall that runs along here. Presently, employees of the club park out in this area. That was one comment at the original DRT meeting. They wanted to see us eliminate that parking area. So when I get to my site plans, I'll show you what we've done. The wetland area is to the south of the existing entrance. Here's the wetland flags. The 100-foot buffer to the wetlands falls right here. So you can see the existing clubhouse and most of the utilities are outside of 100 feet from the wetland area. There's a pavement area in here. About 80% of that's going to be removed, and I'll go through that with the site plan. If you could go to the site plan, Julie. Okay, this is a proposed site plan. So you can see in the light gray scale, that is where the existing building is located. The darker line work is where the proposed club will be constructed. So you can see in size, it's generally close to the same footprint, same size, and that's a key aspect of this project. The club's not looking to increase membership. They're not looking to increase function. They basically just needed to update, you know, 70 years old, and the cost to renovate the club was going to be quite expensive, and there was a vote by the board members and the club members for a new club, and that's why we're here today. The existing curb cut is over here. We're looking to push the curb cut over into this area, so there'll be a curb cut here, and then we're proposing a second curb cut for a loading space and a dumpster area. This will be a service entrance to the building. The main entrance is existing parking up in this area that'll still be utilized, and what we're trying to do is provide a drop-off area for the club as well. So as Kevin stated, this will be more residential in nature, the passenger cars that come in. This service entrance, that's where you'd see the dumpster loaded or any service trucks that come in to drop off for the club. What we try to do is, right now there's a pretty good grade from the street up into the site. We're going to be cutting that grade down by about 2 feet. Over in this area, this is the old pavement line in this area. All this area is going to be removed and grassed. And we're going to construct a rain garden that I can talk about as part of the drainage system as well. The site will have vertical granite curbing along the entrance. The area that I spoke about where employees are parking, there'll be vertical granite curbing added along Grove Street. So between curb cut to curb cut, there'll be vertical granite curbing closing that off, which will be a much nicer streetscape from Grove Street. As far as parking, the parking lot's basically staying the same. The only thing that's changed is we added some handicap parking spaces here. There are some there now, but we've made one van accessible space, and we have two general handicap parking spots, and there'll be a handicap ramp in this location that can provide access to the building. All the building features I'm going to let the architect speak about. He'll get into some detail on that. We'll have a cement concrete walkway here, and then there's existing trails and walkways through the sites that we're tying into. Over at the service entrance, there'll be a door here for members to come out, go up a flight of stairs. There's a retaining wall. It ties into some of the existing walkways that exist around the course. As far as utilities, we're adding new water, new sewer, there'll be fire protection. Right now, we're showing propane for the building, but the club is working with the gas company to try to get gas brought down from up towards Franklin Street, or it may even be up by Forest Street, but they're in works with the gas company to try to get gas service to this building. But since that's not formalized yet, I have shown an area where a propane tank can go. In this area is where the building sewer will run into. The water services will come in over here. There's a utility pole down here, and there's one over here. We're gonna have underground telephone, electric, and cable to the building off of those poles. There'll be a riser provided from the pole here for electric service. There'll be risers provided from the pole here for telephone, electric, cable. As far as site drainage, it's twofold. We try to do a low-impact method for drainage. One is removal of almost 2,000 square feet of pavement within the 100-foot buffer zone to the wetlands. Conservation like that idea. Secondly, we're looking to put in a rain garden. What will happen is for the proposed building, the roof runoff will be collected in a 10,000-gallon rainwater cistern. It's a holding tank, basically. That'll be used for irrigation purposes for the club, for the landscaping features. In the event of a large storm event, there'll be an overflow out to the rain garden. And from the rain garden, there's an emergency overflow that will then drain out to the wetlands. I provided a stormwater report to analysis to the engineering department and evaluated the 2, 10, and 100-year storm event for this site, and there's a reduction in peak rates of stormwater runoff and volumes of runoff for this project in the post-development scenario. One comment that did come up at the conservation meeting and engineering brought up is presently a lot of water sheet flows off onto Grove Street. There's concerns with drainage there. Even though we're providing a net reduction, we are going to look to add a trench grate or a catch basin feature in this area here that will collect any water coming off this hill and then move it out to the rain garden through, I'm gonna put in a crushed stone swale, and that's something that came up with conservation. Just to try to limit the amount of sheet flow runoff to Grove Street. As far as the curb cuts, the policy of the town is you're allowed one curb cut per residential lot unless you have 125 feet of frontage and the curb cuts are separated by at least 125 feet. We have, the curb cuts will be greater than 24 feet. I put on the note, I think they're roughly like 37 feet wide at the throat at Grove Street, and they're separated by about 76 feet. So there's a parking traffic PTTF force, task force in the town that gives recommendations to the Board of Selectmen. They did meet on it. It didn't come up at their last meeting. They are gonna address it at their next meeting at the staff level, and we will be going to the Board of Selectmen for approval of the two curb cuts and the separation of the curb cuts. I think I'll turn it over to Andrew Weaver now to discuss the architecture of the building.
Thanks, Jack. My name is Andrew Weaver. I'm the architect for the project, and what I like to do is spend a few minutes and go through schematically the floor plans and elevations for you. This plan that's on the screen now is the lower level of the proposed club. The functions down there are very similar to what's currently existing in the existing club. Although we do have now a new front entrance in this location here. But we have locker rooms in the back here, and administrative areas and employee areas in that lower right quadrant. We do have an elevator that will be handicapped accessible, and of course all new facilities will meet MAB and ADA standards. The upper floor, please. This is the upper floor. The parking occurs over here. So we actually have a secondary entrance along this line here to an upper hallway. And on the back side of the club is primarily dining and club functions, a 19 pole, a grill, an event dining room, and these are all kind of linked together. And in the middle of the action is the kitchen. Next to that, some public bathrooms here and here. And by turning the club the way we did, we now have the front of the club here set up almost perpendicularly to the center line of Grove Street. And by turning it that 30 degrees, we've moved all the outside dining back to the rear of the building, actually behind the, or next to the putting green, and with views down the ninth fairway. Those outdoor areas on the existing club now occur over here, which are kind of visible actually from Grove Street. So with this new orientation, it moves those activities completely to the rear. So the rear, the building almost acts as a screen to those exterior activities. Dining, you know, lunch, dining events that would spill out of those the dining rooms here at the rear of the club. Okay, next, please. Roof plan, I don't think we need to talk about. This is the architectural drawing of the front of the club. You can see the new entrance here, the covered porch. This is some support space and administrative offices. There's dining up above here. The kitchen is actually behind here. And then there's a small covered porch on the left side there that's really meant to provide lunchtime dining for pool guests, pool members. So during the day, take a break, you're able to get to the club. You don't have to go through the club, you can sit there and have lunch. Next, please. This is the rear of the club. It's a shed roof with gables on the ends, very traditional New England dormers punched in the roof. There's a small shed roof here that partially covers the exterior dining. And you can see all the windows and glass that look out to the golf course. What's shadowed in here is the outdoor dining terrace area that all those doors would lead to. Okay. This is the west elevation facing the upper parking lot. You can see the secondary entrance here, handicap ramp. There's that partially covered exterior terrace area for outdoor dining. This also shows the covered porch area just to the right of the entrance. And I should note that the prominent materials are shingles here, and you see the horizontal siding here on these columns and pilasters. Those are shiplap siding. So it's horizontal siding with the kind of reveal at each board line. Okay. And finally, this is the east elevation, the primary elevation along Grove Street. You can see the service doors and the golf members door here and the stair that would lead up to the first tee. There's also a side door that goes directly into the grill room. This is the grill room here. Again, there's that outdoor dining terrace area and some event dining here, a larger dining room. one of the interesting features here with this roof is that we created a well so that we could get all the mechanical equipment above and behind the roof. So none of it is visible from Grove Street. That was an important goal that we wanted to try to achieve, and we've done that. Okay? Next, sorry. Oh, that's it?
Yeah, unless you want to talk about your rendering.
The rendering would be great.
Yeah.
Here's a rendering along Grove Street. It's just past the curb cut into the drop-off circle, which is here. So we're kind of hitting the corner of the building. We did that, obviously, so that you can see more of the building. But you can see the horizontal banding at the lower level that then becomes the pilasters and columns up above. And it's a kind of a brown finish. We have a sample board here of what that brown looks like. And the shingles up above, it looks very white, but it's actually an off-white, believe it or not. And then the shingles will be a three-tab architectural, like heather wood, or we still need to select something, but it will be a fairly neutral, natural colored, you know, some good texture and shadow line to it, asphalt shingle. We are proposing a cupola. They do have an existing weather vane, which may not survive, but the weather vane and cupola will be one of the features of the front elevation of the new club. Okay. Thank you.
Staff?
I have a few questions, but you might ask them. So.
You might. Questions from the board? Commission?
Yes. I apologize that I haven't spent more time on this. I've gone through the proposal fairly extensively, and I, in spite of all the road construction, I did drive by this afternoon and waded through the water main construction and everything else. I have been to the club on a number of occasions as a guest at the swimming area, and my older son was part of the wait staff for one season. I'm also personally familiar with one of the board members at Dushara Country Club in Concord, which is a quintessential PGA quality major club. I'm disappointed that the plan does not include the entire set of structures. It doesn't include any of the S40 structures serving the swimming pool and in the other areas. It doesn't include the service shed, which is in S40 behind the current parking lot. And I'm quite surprised that you want to rebuild in the same location, because it would seem to be a great opportunity to build the new clubhouse at the back of the parking area away from Grove Street. And while that construction is going on, you would still be able to operate using the existing clubhouse. And after the new construction were essentially ready, you could remove the existing clubhouse and clear up that area dramatically. I mean, it's a beautiful location. You've got tons of room. I'm not sure why you really want it up close to a back road. It's a wonderful building, perfectly functional, but I think it's in the wrong place.
Back up a little bit, because I've unfortunately not had that much time to dissect this under yet. Existing square footage, existing capacity to what the proposed square footage, proposed capacity would be.
Do you have that?
exact numbers, I believe that, probably.
14 and change.
Yeah, it's,
I don't know that she's asking about square footage, she's asking about membership.
No, I'm asking about square foot, like, build, actual building, square footage.
So the existing's over 14,000.
Okay.
This one's just under 13,862.
Yeah.
So it's under, under the existing one, the new one's under, by over 100 square feet.
Okay. Are we proposing a membership or increase in membership capacity at all?
No, we are not.
I have a question following on that. So what is the occupancy right now for, like, the maximum occupancy that you could have if you had an event?
140.
140? And that, what is the number that you're?
That would be in separate rooms, but.
If all the rooms were full at one time?
If all the rooms were full at one time, it would be 140 plus 40, 180, approximately 180.
180, okay.
But I would premise that because under the building code, 15 square feet per person for assembly would drive that number probably three times what they're experiencing. You know, you have to go by what the code says in terms of design loads for doors and sprinklers and HVAC, the whole works. So the calculation per space is based off the code and the assembly use or use of that space to get a total capacity for a building.
That's egress capacity, we're looking more at occupancy, actual occupancy, tables and seats and.
Intensity of use.
No, that's the same though, that's straight out of the building code. Square footage determines the.
You have to design that egress system to that number, but they could be limited in seats. They could be limited in seats, in fact, by their parking capacity.
I guess theoretically it could.
Because we're assuming you're gonna meet code, but we're concerned about the site plan and that would be traffic and parking more so. John?
So, I guess, can you help me understand the, the difference in terms of like the, I'm gonna call it gathering space, community space, gathering space, of what you have now versus what this then provides, sort of like you, right, you have, some space for dining, but there's also other, function space? And what's, sort of what's that delta, how is that?
Well, currently, we're in a situation where if we, for example, have an outside event, let's say a bridal shower, and we also have a golf, Saturday morning golf tournament or Sunday morning golf tournament, which is the norm. The issue becomes of people are sharing the same space, so it becomes problematic in some ways and a little bit awkward in others. So, one of the goals in designing the new building was to be able to keep those things mutually exclusive so that, you know, one could have a shower and one could have a tournament and not be bumping into each other. That's basically the goal that we tried to achieve.
Have you noticed on the design, we tried to create a more modular capability so you could have a, as Bob said, a shower function and not disturb that with the activities that go on in the normal club, have lunch or a drink afterwards on the 19th hole.
I have a bunch of questions and issues on the, some of the more detailed site plan stuff, but I think I'd like to hear bigger issues, because those some of those other, the details might end up, I don't want to spend that time on the details if those end up changing, so.
Okay. I mean, David brings up a good point. This is really the only sort of overall site plan we have here. It seems to show the structures on it. So I'm curious where the wetland lines are on the S40 section and why you couldn't build back there. If you don't build back there, then what is the construction schedule? It's winter? When do you shut down the golf course?
We'd be looking at the fall to potentially be starting this project if everything aligned. End of fall, winter time period.
It's pretty brave. You might not be ready for the season.
It won't be ready for the season.
Okay, so you're going to forego a whole season or part of a season?
We won't probably be able to use the clubhouse facility as we have it today, but members would still be able to, we hope, be able to use the golf course, et cetera.
Okay. Wow. I think you need a bigger site plan that shows laydown area and construction sequencing. So
I did do that, Nick. On sheet two, I show a demolition plan, and the reason I did that is not only for this board but for conservation. I wanted to show them where staging areas would be, soil stockpile, porta potties, construction trailers. I wanted to kind of show how this site would be set up. More to show conservation that it's outside of their jurisdiction and that we'd be meeting Wetland Protection Act, but also for this board to see how it would be set up.
Yeah, but it's sheet three of seven.
Sheet three of seven.
But really, I mean, you're putting the contractor right in the parking lot. Where are his employees going to park and the golfers? That's what I'm saying, is I don't know that you can put your parking on the green somewhere.
Did you ever go down the back of the course?
No.
So there's still a lot of pieces, as you know, in a project like this that are going on. A lot of this work starts, let's call it November through May. There's no activity really going on at the club during that time. When the golf season starts, which is usually the May time period, we're hoping that the exterior part of the building has been, a lot of that work has been done, the demolition has been completed, etc. And then the members have an opportunity for the back half of the parking lot down towards where the maintenance building is to do their parking. So away from where the construction activity is, it might make it a little bit longer of a walk than they're used to today, mm-hmm. but that was something that we had to take into consideration. There is no good time to do this project.
From a membership standpoint. You might be extending that construction season if it's not a good winter like we just had.
We normally close the clubhouse November 30th anyways.
Okay.
So it seemed like an appropriate time to
All right, so going back to David's point though about building elsewhere on the site, what's the primary driver for putting it where it is?
Primary driver for where we ended up with the clubhouse?
Mm-hmm.
I think there's a cost component of that in terms of being able to get access to water, sewage, et cetera, that exists today, that we felt that this was an appropriate place. We explored a couple of different options about where you could potentially put the clubhouse, but when we looked at all of those options, we felt that this was the right place for the membership. As we went through this, we tried to take into consideration how the clubhouse would be used for the members. So as I think Andrew mentioned, we wanted to turn the clubhouse to take advantage of views from the dining area down the ninth fairway, so that would be a very pleasing location. We also moved the outside gathering area into a more formal place with the clubhouse now fielding a lot of the noise from that, because now it's facing down the fairway on the ninth hole. So we felt that this was the logical place to put the building when we looked at all the options from the impact to members, the cost of the project, et cetera, et cetera.
Additionally, one thing that really drives the location of all clubhouses is the routing of the golf course. This is the ideal location based on the layout of the golf course, having the first tee and the ninth green in this location converging together. And once you you pull a clubhouse away from that, the functionality of the course and the membership and their relationship to the country club or the golf clubhouse becomes very problematic. You'd almost have to redesign the golf course if we were to move this clubhouse, say, in a back lot area. It would change one, it would change the whole routing of the course. And that would be a big issue for, I think, the club.
And just to help a little, because I don't know if it shows up on the plans themselves, if you think across from where the green is up there, is where the pro shop is, so you finish on the ninth hole, you're dropping off clubs. Was that where it is?
Yeah.
Jack, thank you. So the you're dropping off your clubs, you're stopping your round, and then you're walking over to the clubhouse. That seems like it's a normal gathering spot, which is kind of where the traffic flow is today. It's a normal spot for people to go in, go to the shower, locker room area, or use the main area for sandwich, drink, a lunch, etc.
By the same token, golfers are used to walking more than 100 feet.
You have carts? You have carts, I assume.
The carts go to the pro shop area. That's correct. That's where they're returned.
So
we don't want to have another reason for that. We've got to be careful about the movement of carts across in the parking lot. We want to keep all the traffic away from that.
The ninth green finishes here, where I'm circling. So from the ninth green, you would actually take your golf cart here up to the pro shop, drop it off, and go right into the clubhouse as well.
Well, not if you're disabled or limited in mobility, right? You have to go to the west entrance.
No, this is on grade here. So this is a path.
Yep.
That would go directly at grade here to that rear entrance.
But I can't get into the members' entrance that you said is down in the southeast corner?
What you would do is go in and go to the elevator and then down to the locker rooms.
Hmm. Okay, so in point of, you're highlighting the fact that the plans provided do not include all of the things that influence the design, as it doesn't include the layout of the golf the holes. It does not include the complete parking lot. Does not include the building serving the swimming area. So it's what you're presented is a clubhouse only. I'm not sure that it gives us enough information to understand.
We're not changing any of the parking lot. Nothing's being changed to the parking lot.
You're not proposing any changes to the lot, yes.
Or the other buildings.
But those all influence how the space is used, and that's information that we need to understand why and how you got to where you are, how the parking lot is used, how the circulation is used. Yeah, you're not planning on anything, but that's information that, I mean, you guys know it. You're there all the time. We aren't. So we need to have that information, I think, is what it, so that we can understand how you got to where you are and how the changes will impact neighbors and stormwater and parking and all that sort of thing, even if you aren't.
Yeah, I mean, right now, the biggest concern I have, there are a few other pieces, but the biggest concern I have is this loading space. Loading curb cut with the dumpster on that street, and the rendering cuts off right before you see it. So, I don't know what you're using to do this, if it's SketchUp or Revit or whatever. Can you actually shoot it from a little further down Grove Street so I can see that dumpster? I did ride through there on Sunday as well, slowly, because the road's a mess. I don't think the first curb cut's going to be an issue as you approach it. There seems to be a good sight line. It's coming from the north, I guess. And I understand there's limited traffic up on that side as far as residents go. The compost yard is there. But it's just that loading spot's just a little weird right now. If you could get somebody into it, you know, get right off the road and be able to make a 3-point turn within it, it'd be a little safer than having somebody on the into it. But then there's, what is the visual impact of that dumpster enclosure? I'd like to see what that looks like. Somehow, scale, grade. We'll write down a grade there, right?
Yeah,
right now there's a...
It's that grade, and there's a retaining wall on this side. So this retaining wall's 4 to 5 feet high. So the dumpster will be built into that wall. But from Grove Street, you know, it's going to be enclosed. We'd have to put some landscaping, some other features to help buffer that dumpster.
The retaining wall is holding back the grade or holding up the dumpster?
Holding back the grade.
So that retaining, there's another retaining wall, right?
Yeah.
I'm sorry, an existing retaining wall right above where it says street?
There's a wall here now right along the lot line.
But then keep going. Yeah, right there, right? Is that a retaining wall?
Yes.
Yes.
Yep. That's an existing.
So would that be the retaining? Would the other retaining wall be about that same height?
I can't speak to that. I don't know how high it is, but I know this wall is going to be 4 to 5 feet high at the back end of the dumpster.
So it covers the dumpster. Covers the first 4 to 5 feet of the dumpster.
Correct.
Side. It's nestled into that thing.
Correct.
Okay. And the propane tank is on grade. Proposed propane tank?
Below grade.
You can bury them. And like I said, they're hoping that they're pretty far along with the gas company. It's just trying to get their construction schedule to work with when the gas company could bring the service down, trying to coordinate timing.
So what's the schedule on the road? Are they going to pave the roadway and tell you you can't cut it up for 3 years?
Well, that's, I'm going to have a talk with the engineering department. Typically with water projects, they'll put a binder course down, they'll let it sit through the winter, and then in the spring they come and top it to allow for any settlement.
They're doing a mill and overlay.
Okay, thank you.
So I'll have to check with the engineering department.
All right.
But typically with trench work, even if they're milling and overlaying the road, with trench work they allow the trench to, unless they use flowable fill, which is expensive, they allow it to settle over the winter months and then they'll top it in the spring.
Okay, and the other question I had was, you want to forego doing a photometric because you say that the site's large and that you're not impacting it? I really would like to know what the photometrics are of the impact of the lighting along this front piece here. And I mean, I think your lighting vendor will do that for you for nothing.
We've tried. We've tried a few times. They are dark sky fixtures. And the luminaire is actually shielded, so you actually get a cone down on the ground. It's not visible. They're quite nice features, fixtures. I think you may have cuts of them.
I do have this bollard doesn't look like it's dark, like it's shielded.
Yeah, the lamp is actually up in the very top of that fixture.
You said there's a plan that shows all this lighting?
Yes.
Scale. Do you have any lighting above the first floor on the building?
No.
Well, they must because of the outdoor seating.
Well, that'd be underneath this. Your outdoor seating is covered.
Yes.
It's also north facing, by the way, so it'd be kind of cold in the chilly weather. I mean, there's some up at that second level on the east elevation. So you're potentially seeing up into that guy. And what about site lighting? Anything on the front edge? I know that you came in to get approval to light the sign, even though you never did it. So you have approval to light the entrance sign. What's the plan for the entrance sign? Is that going to be lit?
Right now, we have the application for the sign permits right now. We have one that's going in the island as our Meadowbrook sign, and then we're trying to figure out, we're going to get two, one for the front of the overhang that says Meadowbrook.
Okay. I know I've got a bunch of other little things. Do you have anything?
Well, I didn't see any parking calculations. Do we have parking?
I think we gave a number of total parking spaces. I think it was 95.
Existing.
Existing.
And the same.
Same. And the end, when I met with the club early on, they already roughly had this location picked out. So my scope of service, we were trying to disturb as little as possible of the site, and that's why we show the limit of work line where it is, not affecting the existing parking. If I have to go survey locate, you know, pool and other wetland areas where we're not even proposing to work, it would add a lot of cost on to for them for as far as engineering. I don't know what that will gain unless is it unless the board feels strongly that this needs to be, the building needs to be relocated to further into the lot. But there's a good amount of work there to survey locate. For the amount of detail, you know, if you want all the wetland lines shown and everything else, that's a lot of work.
My concern here is more that so you're keeping the same number of members, but increasing the space, but not changing anything else. I know when I drive by there, parking lots full. Oftentimes, I go walk my dog down Forest, and oftentimes when I drive by on a Saturday morning, parking lot appears to be full, or at least there's cars spilling out onto to Grove Street, parking along the entrance and wherever they can. So I guess my concern really is that I assume right now that you have there's some limitation on the amount of people that use a club because you have limited space. I mean, the golf course is not going to change, so all your golfers, that's what it is. But there's some limitation because you can only stuff so many people comfortably that building. You're increasing that square footage. It should be more comfortable. That's part of the point. But you're not necessarily increasing parking, or there's probably a limited way that's comfortable for you to for some caps on usage to be put in there.
We currently do that and we will continue to do that. We don't take any functions from Memorial Day to Labor Day on any Saturday or Sunday from morning until after 4 o'clock in the afternoon, so that our parking lot is fully dedicated to golf and swim and tennis. So we will continue to do that. We only have so many spaces, and we're very cognizant of that. And we're very conscious of the fact that we want our golf to have a space to park, or in the swimming department. The reason you see cars, if you can go by there on Saturday or Sunday, that are parked along Grove Street, is usually because they don't want to park all the way down the end of the lot, and it's a lot easier to park on Grove Street and just go to the pro shop. It's not because they're not in the space.
So there will be people parking in that other driveway right in front of the pro shop there. I guess what I'm thinking about is your application is for a special permit, basically because you're already there and you've been operating since the 100 years, which is great, and it's a great part of the community. If this were a new facility, there's no way that you'd get the permit to build this. It just you don't have enough parking. You're probably I don't know. I can't speak for the rest of the board, but some of these things being so close to the road, you would never you just wouldn't get that permit if you were a new facility. So I guess that's where I'm what I'm grappling with is you're increasing the facility, but not meeting those same requirements as if you were a new one.
I understand what you just said.
That's what I'm trying to grapple with.
But just remember what we said earlier, the physical building itself is actually smaller than what it is today, right? So we're reducing the size, we're not expanding the building itself. We are adding a little bit more seating on the outside because we want to give our membership a different opportunity to have a dining experience outside as opposed to being inside during the season. But the physical building itself has gone from 14.6 to 13.9, just round numbers, in terms of the physical structure of the space itself. So we're not actually expanding the building or the opportunity for people. The same number of lockers downstairs for the same number of members that we have in place today for both women and men. So we're not expanding the locker room areas or the bathroom areas, et cetera. It's a clubhouse designed more practically for the membership of the future and what we see today and the trends that are happening to give us a structure that is going to survive the next 70 years, just like this one has, touch wood someplace. What we want to do is at this time, it's the right time for us to be thinking about these decisions. That's why we've made it. It's not to expand the building or the use or the consumption of it. We're keeping it the same. And that was one of the things that we made in our guiding principles when we talked about taking on this project. We established a set of guiding principles that said membership will stay the way it is today. We're a 9-hole course. We will have a swimming capability. And as Bob mentioned, a lot of our activity happens early Saturday and Sunday mornings. Once you finish 18 holes of golf, you have a lunch, a beer, and you leave. That creates an opening for another wave of a function or an activity in the afternoon. And although the parking space seems full, it's kind of on a rotational basis because people are moving in and out of their activities. Most of the pool members will take shifts of I'm there in the morning and then I have to leave or vice versa. So we see that a lot in terms of the turnover of the parking that makes it acceptable. So just a point of clarity.
That's all good. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments.
Okay. We're going to take some public comments now. Understanding that we know many of you have the same concerns, let's try to get as many new items and these comments as possible. It's not just keep repeating themselves. So make sure that you state your name and address for the record. Yes, sir.
Yeah, my name's Nick Bonanno. I live at 283 Grove Street, directly opposite the club. I'm the next to the last house before you get to the clubhouse. I've lived there 35 years. I've also been a member of the club for 34 years. I'm a past board member back about 25 years ago. I'm not here to say anything negative about the club per se, but more about this plan. But I will, as some have done, acknowledge the success the club has had for well over 100 years, and it's due to the members over the past century plus that have been extremely prudent in the use of their funds and maintaining the grounds and building that's there. And in fact, I dug up the corporate charter for Meadowbrook Golf Club. It's funny to read this in light of some of the comments that were made about how far somebody might have to walk. But in 1902, when the charter was authorized by the state of Massachusetts, the purpose, as submitted by the members of Meadowbrook, the Meadowbrook Golf Club Corporation of Reading, Massachusetts, the purpose for which the corporation is constituted is the encouragement of athletic exercise. Period. Nothing more, nothing less. And it's amazing that we're now talking about the real fancy clubhouse and not the exercise. The club's first clubhouse was a log cabin about 500 feet off of Grove Street, well off the road, up on a hill on the east side of Grove Street. And then around 1920, as the club got more popular, more members joined, they purchased the land that you're looking at here on the other side of Grove Street that consisted of the Samuel Foster House, circa 1710, 1711. And the Foster home had a barn. And the barn became the new clubhouse. And around 1940-something, that barn burned down. And the club rebuilt in the same exact spot. And of course, they added a couple of wings onto it. And that is the clubhouse that's there today. It started with the barn. only because old man Foster had to build a barn next to the road. And if you look at the layout, I know you have pictures that the club submitted in their application, but you'll clearly see it's a barn because there's ground access at one level. You go up a little steep incline, and there's ground level access to the second level. And that's exactly how barns are built. So here we are today. Meadowbrook's been extremely successful, no question. And if I can ask, I'm here as a neighbor. I have to admit, I'm here as a neighbor more than a member, but I've enjoyed my 34 years at the club. And Kevin and the others, if they can help me out, I mean, the membership has been fairly full, or near full, for quite a long time, since the late 80s, early 90s. And that's great for the club. And so when I hear talk about we're going to put this clubhouse in and membership's going to be the same, and I think several people have raised the point about the intensity of the use of the facilities and the effect it has. So let me just go through a punch list if I can. The membership has not increased how the club's expanded just in the last 25 years. The 1711, 1712 Foster Emerson House was removed, which was near the existing entrance. That was moved, and it's further down Grove Street now. The club was able to sell that, I think, for a dollar. And somebody took on the project of moving it and restoring it. But that house was moved, and that became more parking. In the mid-90s, the club constructed a new building on Grove Street, about 80, 90 feet or so north of the existing clubhouse. That became the new pro shop. The pro shop used to be inside the existing clubhouse. So the pro shop moved, then the club renovated the entire clubhouse to expand dining, the lounge area, put in a larger bar, had more seats for dining. The bag storage was moved out of the existing clubhouse into the pro shop, and that became more office space. Some time ago, about maybe 10 years ago, 12 years ago, they constructed a new, larger maintenance building in the rear, near the rear parking lot, and the existing maintenance building remained. So now there's two maintenance buildings. The back part of the parking lot that's not paved was cleaned up, and that hasn't been talked about. That is available for additional parking. The paved parking is roughly 92 spaces. And the dirt area behind that can probably hold about 40 to 50 vehicles. They have to jam them in there, but there is some additional parking there. And then several years ago, the club added an outdoor deck off the lounge for more dining and bar, you know, service. It's a small deck. It's, you know, your typical Trex deck, but the capacity is somewhere around 25 people. And then down by the pool and tennis area, permanent terraces were added some time ago with permanent barbecue grills, and that's enjoyed by a lot of people. So even though the membership has been relatively full for 25 plus years, the club has been expanding in other ways through physical structures, trying to carve out more space to create more room for the same number of people. Well, I can appreciate having a nice lounge after you finish a round of golf. It's a 9-hole golf course. There's only 4 people per hole. So they're not going to have more than 36 people playing golf at one time, plus some number of people waiting either to go onto the course or people that have come off the course and now they're in the lounge where another group goes out and plays. So there is a lot of traffic that comes and goes from the club. And it's not so much the golfers, per se, but it's a lot part of the swim families where they're drop kids off and running back and forth. But the club, and I can say this because I live across the street, I can't say I've measured it and counted cars, but I know there's more cars coming in and out today than 30 years ago. And to see this is really a larger building than what we have now. What's not being counted as functional space is that huge deck on the back. That deck by itself is over 2,000 square feet. intent is to make that as integral to the interior of the clubhouse as any room inside the clubhouse. That back wall, 40% of it opens up with wide patio doors. So the intent is to have people flow freely in and out of the inside of the club. And when they're outside, dining and drinking, the noise travels. As I said, the existing clubhouse today has a small deck that holds about 25 people, and it's not uncommon to have a dozen or so out there in the afternoon, had a couple of beers. I'm sitting on my patio behind my own house. I can hear word for word the conversations that are taking place. I can hear some of the colorful language. Well, I don't mind them having a good time, but at some points it gets annoying. And I know my neighbors can also hear it. We've talked about it. But, you know, most of us have been brought up to try to be good neighbors and not complain. As I said, I'm a member. I bite my lip because, you know, I don't want to ruffle too many feathers. So that's a little bit of the background. And this proposal, you know, I give the club lots of credit for wanting to do something new. I have a lot of the same issues that you folks have expressed. I know my neighbors have a similar issue. But first, the overall size of this building and being so close to the curb, it's overwhelming. This building is about 100 feet long. And as he said, it's being rotated more to face Grove Street. Currently, the existing clubhouse is more perpendicular. So now it's going to be rotated more to Grove Street, and it's going to be even more overwhelming. I'm not even sure what the height of the building is, because I didn't see any heights on the plans that were submitted. But it appears to be well over 35 feet. The homes in the area are roughly about 1,500 square feet. This building is at least 8 times larger than the neighboring homes. The interior of the building, and not knowing really what the club's plans are, they really don't. Anybody can pick this plan up and look at it and see there's potentially three defined spaces outside of the lounge area. And they can be expanded, obviously, and they have access to the deck and the dining side. There's money to be made with special events and functions. The club does hold them. In the past, it used to be strictly club members. It is a private club. But they do have outside events. They do have special events. They've had national touring acts come in and perform. And I leave town because I don't want to be around for the aftermath. But it's not a concert venue. And so the types of events need to be monitored and somehow, I don't want to say restricted, but there needs some limits put upon those. So the overall size of this building, and I agree with Mr. Tuttle, this building, and I think Mr. Weston said the same thing, clubhouses are not placed near the street. And I submitted something late today, for what it's worth. I looked at every private and semi-private golf clubhouse in the North Shore just to see where they're located. And I specifically looked at clubs that were established between 1875 and 1925. And not surprisingly, most of those clubhouses are away from residents, away from the curb of the street. They're off the road. The clubs need their privacy, and the neighbors need their privacy, and there needs to be a buffer between the two. And this is an excellent opportunity for Metalport to place the clubhouse that they feel they need well off the road. And Julie, one of the attachments I sent today has a better aerial shot of this whole area. And you should be able to see some of the other major structures in the area, like the homes along that section of Grove Street.
Is it one of the ones that you sent me later or earlier?
Yeah, it was later.
Okay.
Yep. I think it's the...
This one?
No, it's... It's, I had in the letter which attachment it was. I think it was before the clubs. Yeah, can you spin that one around? If I can come up here, I don't want to. This is heading north down Grove Street. Here's the club. Here's 293, 283, where I live, 273. The pro shop is up here. So I forget who suggested moving it further back, but certainly here's the existing parking area that extends all through here up to about here. Here's the new maintenance building. I'm not a designer, and I'm not telling anybody what to do, but if I was going to do it, it would be up in this area. Somewhat on the where the course is and somewhat on the parking lot. Here's your ninth hole, your finishing hole. And that's, you know, back 150 feet more. And that allows all this to be used for parking, and they can design a much better entrance than what's proposed, because the current proposed entrance is directly opposite this driveway. But the traffic that flows through the street, this person's going to be backing into effectively what's a bad four-way intersection. By getting the clubhouse further off the street, it addresses the issue of the second curb cut, which I can't imagine some of these 40-plus foot trailer trucks that come down here to deliver beer and soda and some of the food provision trucks, how they're going to be backing into that space. Grove Street should not be used as a staging area for Meadowbrook. Meadowbrook needs to keep its affairs on its property. They have 60 acres of land to do their business. They get to the clubhouse further back, they can have a better located main entrance. They can handle both their delivery vehicles and pedestrian vehicles. Conversely, if they really want to stay close to the street, they have all this land over here. This is where they popped the pro shop 15, 20 years ago. They could swap them out, build their little clubhouse up here, keep the pro shop here, and they can still see the ninth green. So there's options. But the key is, as far as the neighbors in the immediate area are concerned, is to get this building off the curb. It is overwhelming in size and scale. And it's inappropriate for a residential neighborhood. To have a 30-foot or 35-foot setback for a building this size, that's no different than the setback for these homes. Having a second curb cut 75 feet from the first, and having it in the curb of the street, it's hard to pick up on this picture, but when that curbing is installed the way it's proposed, which is right on the street edge, you're going to see a really defined curb. And it's still going to be somewhat blind. And what you can't see on this picture is Grove Street, when you're driving north, there's a bit of a dip as you go by the first tee, because this is an elevated tee. They tee off over the road. So there's a bit of a dip, and then you have a slight incline up. And if you're down here and you're looking this way, even if you can't see what's behind that bit of a crest. So there's going to be a shortened reaction time if that driveway was put where they showed as proposed. And right now, a lot of cars coming out of Meadowbrook use all this extra area as almost like an on-ramp from a highway. And they pull out, and they're driving, and they're looking so they can kind of clear the curb. And it's a safety zone because that's how they avoid accidents. Once this entrance is pulled out to a formal curb, this whole area gets really, really tight. And the people that walk down here, you know, whether they're dog walkers or just walkers, or the high school track team comes down here every afternoon, the girls and the boys, they're doing their training, they're running down Grove Street. This gets really difficult. Am I over my time?
Yeah. No. I'd like to hear from some others as well.
And lots of other folks have some concerns. So.
Else?
from the guys that live on 267 Rose Street. And I was a past member at Meadowbrook. You know, my girls, they used to be able to walk over there. She had to go to the pool. I would not allow them to do that if they were here today. You know, it's a dangerous area down there now. My feeling with the clubhouse, wanting to erect it where it is present, is it's only a convenience. The pool is already there. You're going to turn it a little bit. You know, I think, you know, what you mentioned, Mr. Tuttle, is the best scenario for the club, you know, and the neighbors, is to get it up and off the road. Okay, and, you know, all I heard was about the golfers. Well, there's neighbors here as well. So we have to take into consideration what's the best scenario here for both the neighbors, you and the club. So everybody is happy and we want to live our lives because it impacts our lives there as well. You know, I've been here for over 30 years myself. And the changes down there as far as the traffic, they're horrendous. So, you know, we need to take that into consideration. Maybe waiting for somebody to get killed or injured before we do something that makes sense. But I think the proposal to get that off the street as back as far as we can will be the true ideal situation. Thank you.
Thanks. Hi, I'm Debbie Powers. I live on 256 Grove Street, and I've been a resident for 55 years. And two of the things that they were mentioning is that, you know, with this big plan, the building will be beautiful, but where it is sits right now, it's not going to work. We have 2,500 cars on a Saturday and Sunday going in and out on Grove Street with the compost and everything. You multiply that by two, you're talking 5,000 cars on Grove Street, whether they're going to Meadowbrook or they're going down. And they have taken, you can look back on your thing here, but they have counted. So on a Saturday and Sunday on compost week, it's about 25 in and 25 out. One of the concerns I have, he was pointing out that the zoning thing that you did down on by the, it's not in this picture. The zoning, what it's called?
Water.
Yeah, the water garden, is that what you said?
Rain garden.
Rain garden.
Rain garden. Okay, so right here, this is the rain garden. Ooh.
Oh, sorry, I'm just gonna make it bigger.
Yeah, thank you.
Right there?
One second.
Is that the rain garden?
Yeah.
Yes.
And what exactly does that do?
Collect stormwater runoff drainage.
Okay, so then where does that go? You said down, this is the wetlands?
No. So just so everyone understands what a rain garden is, it's basically a depression in the ground. There's landscape plantings. Water will flow to this area. It allows the plants to thrive. So it's a landscape feature, plus it's stormwater. There's an outlet. It's not shown on this, but on a separate plan, which is the grading plan, shows an outlet. So when water reaches a certain level, it'll flow out towards this wetland area here. Not out towards Grove Street, out towards the wetland area.
Okay, so this wetland area right here, who owns that land?
I think the club does. I'd have to check.
Do you know the answer to that?
I do.
The drainage ditches?
I own that land.
Good answer.
When you make this here, and then you all said that it's all going down there, that's one of my problems I have with my land, because you blocked up the Meadowbrook.
Well, one thing I can add to that, I didn't mean to cut you off, but we have to show less water is moving to the wetland area than presently, and there's going to be less water that gets to that wetland.
So that would help it?
There'd be less water going towards your property.
So that would help
it? I'll get the answer to see what the lot line is. I'll show it on the next plan.
Yeah.
I can just add something. roads collect water in pipes and move it that way.
Okay.
This allows the water to percolate through the soil, so it's a more sustainable feature. It gets the water back into, it recharges the soil faster than, say,
so it wouldn't do any harm on having that?
He's not allowed to do that. Engineering would confirm that. That's
okay.
Actually one of the better protections that you have is against water and conservation stuff. They have to meet those requirements. They can put up an ugly building, but they can't screw around with the water.
Okay.
Not saying your building's ugly, by the way. I'm just saying that that's one of the things that you're expected against typically is stormwater.
Stormwater?
Yeah. The notion of infiltration is when the water comes out of the sky or from the snow or whatever, you want to get it underground without washing away existing topsoil or so forth. So basically the infiltration is to get it back underground where it belongs.
Oh, okay. It won't cause like a...
No.
Okay.
It's basically prevent the surface flooding.
Okay. And that's all I had to say. I think the building's very nice, but I agree that it's too close to Grove Street, and we live there every day, and I think there's more people here. We live there every day. It is every day. I've been there for 50 years. I hear the pool people, but I don't have a problem with it. Doesn't matter, but it does when they do have parties. I can hear it, and I'm on the street.
You said you're at 256?
Yes.
So 260 is between you and that wetland?
Yes.
And
she owns behind us.
I own behind.
That kind of wraps around.
Yeah. But not what we're looking at right there.
No, that looks like close.
That's our property.
The property in the woods
away.
Down by
next
the pool.
Trust me, I tried to have the trees come back and found out.
Yeah, because the way that the story's back.
I only know because I tried to have the trees come back.
Okay. Well, see, that's where your larger site plan, even if you just use a GIS or something maybe that shows these property lines and shows the wetlands layer. You know, you don't have to go out and flag that, but at least we can see that you're within 10 or 15 feet of something. You don't have to be within a foot of it.
Yeah.
Right, but what I'm looking at is that strip of land between 260 and the clubhouse.
Yeah.
You know, that's several hundred feet.
Yeah, the rain garden's going over here.
Right, it must
right.
be.
So you're way over here.
I'm way over here?
Yeah.
Because I go. My land goes all the way around on the back of his side land, all the way to Meadowbrook by the pool. So that's what I'm a little confused at. Where's the pool now?
The wetland area is here, and
okay.
then the drainage at Grove Street comes through a series of catch basins and drain manholes and empties out into this brook right here.
Meadowbrook.
No, it's a drainage ditch.
It's a drainage ditch.
Okay. Well, it used to be Meadowbrook.
But so the wetland area I'm showing is on the club's property.
Okay.
Yep.
And you can see where the pool is on that overall site plan as well.
I can see the pool
right
there.
There's the pool.
Oh, okay. All right. Listen.
Yes, sir.
Ed Pebble, 273 Grove Street. I'm a couple houses down from 293, which is directly across from it. And a couple of things. The plans we get from the city, there's absolutely no measurements on there at all for the size of the old club and the size of the new club. I didn't see any on it at all. You know, to tell the size of it. And if you can bring up the deck, the new deck that they're proposing. I think there's two decks they're proposing. There's one there and one on the side. From what I understand, that's going to hold probably 80 people.
Over 100.
Over 100?
100, 125.
And how about the side deck?
Well, I mean, in total.
Two decks in total. Okay.
The west side deck is larger than the existing deck.
The rear deck, the rear terrace area, the maximum allowed by under the code is 68 people. And that's 15 square feet per person. That's very tight. 15 square feet per person.
Are there supposed to be measurements for everything, though? Shouldn't you have measurements on your plans that you submit?
They are.
Sorry,
you
could address your questions to the board.
I'm sorry.
All the plans I have scales and dimensions on them, so I'm not sure what you're looking at.
Okay, then I must have a different plan. Okay.
But these are available
They're all available.
I'll get a copy of them. And also the new driveway for the drop off, how big is that going to be? For the food and the dumpster in that area right there, do you have measures on that?
Yeah, which dimension, the width or the depth?
The width and the depth.
Jack?
It's labeled, if you zoom in on that area, Julie, I can. There's a dimension right here on the curb cut.
Forty-four point nine feet.
And how far back is it going?
This loading space, I know, is 12 by 35, so 35 feet.
So what's the size of an average tractor trailer? It's 40 feet, isn't it? They're gonna be sticking out into the street?
Through the chairman, the loading space requirements are 12 by 35 in this town, and that's what we provided.
You can see that vehicle doesn't go beyond the curb. It's sort of butting up against a dark property line, I guess. There's some distance. I don't know that so much the vehicle sticking out, although I've seen small Dunkin' Donuts get, 18-wheeler deliveries. It's more about
sometimes
the
sometimes we get a good sized
it's more about the movement
down there
of that vehicle
and to make it in there, they're gonna have
more
to go
about
past
that,
it and they're gonna have to be backing in, so
it's more about that truck backing in there and how long it takes for it to do that's the concern with that space right now,
right.
Not that it can't hold a truck.
Don't forget that is a little bit of a blind corner as well coming
yeah there is a blind corner coming around,
so his nose is on the street.
My daughter lives down the street and she'll come up there and they'll see people flying across the from the whether the club is or the go across to get to the first hole, and they're not even looking, they're just whizzing right across there. She's almost hit a couple of them. In fact, today I was picking up my granddaughter coming back. I had to jump my brakes on, and someone was shooting across the street without even looking. So it is a blind area that they go zooming across.
Yeah. Immediately adjacent to the retaining wall is the cart crossing, which is part of the golf course. There was a note, and one of the things says basically to play nine holes, you've got to cross the Grove Street four times, either over or back. And it's one of those walkways is directly next to the proposed loading bay area.
Anybody else? Yes.
Suzanne Cox. I live at 259 Grove Street, which is the third or fourth house up from the club across the street. My main concerns are traffic and noise. The traffic has already been expressed, but the noise level is a bit of an issue, especially if the wind's blowing the right way. I'm further up than Nick, but I can't hear voices. But if they had the swim meet the other Saturday, it was so loud I had to shut my slider door on my deck because everybody's screaming and the horns going off and things like that. So if you have more outdoor space and more people outside, it's definitely going to contribute to the noise for the neighbors. Is there currently a time limit on functions at night there on the weekends, or
general bylaw controls that? The general bylaw that has that? Outdoor use?
For a private club?
Probably going to be regulated by the liquor license. I would point to that regulation.
Are there hours?
That's correct. The liquor license states that we can serve alcohol. It's a state license, and with no, I don't think there was any amendment by the town. It states we can serve alcoholic beverages until 1 o'clock in the morning. I hasten to add that we tell all our functions that we have to give last call 11 o'clock.
Look into the other, we're looking to see if there's any other hour regulations, but
yeah,
I mean, has there been a lot of violations? Have there been complaints?
The police reported no complaints. Usually there's only functions a few times a year with music or something like that that's going on later, after 10 or 11. I'm further enough away, it's buffered, but I can still hear it. But if they have more functions.
Hi, Dave Johnson, 255 Grove Street. I echo a lot of the sentiments about the construction, but what I just want to reiterate is the safety concern I have about not only the plan, but also just the volume of traffic, the speed limit's a separate issue. But I mean, I was just walking my dog tonight, and you take your life into your hands sometimes with. It doesn't have to be dusk or late at night. It's, you know, noontime, and I would just like the board to take into consideration. It can't be expressed enough. Bob wasn't overstating it. It's extremely dangerous, and there's been a lot of complaints from a lot of the neighbors regarding the safety. So I'd like you to take that into consideration.
It's got to be the hours, because I hadn't gone down there since I was working on the water plant, and I rode through there this weekend, and it was pretty dead, so it's got to be some other hour that it's getting. It's a dead end, right?
Would you go late at night or early in the morning?
It was probably 6 on Saturday.
On a Saturday or a Monday?
Saturday morning.
6 p.m. ish.
You can sit my driveway.
What you can do is bring your kids to run around my yard and tell me how you feel.
No, I'm not disputing it. I'm just letting you know that I hadn't been down there in a while.
Yeah, I think the experience you're talking about is if you drive down and drive back, you know, at a, you know, a brisk pace, if you're just going down there to, you know, drop off the compost, you go in and out, you know, it's not readily apparent. But living there day in, day out for the last 16 years, and I also lived across town for another 20 years. I've just seen the increase in the last 16 years. I mean, my wife, you know, someone was coming out of Grove Street, and God forbid you try to back out and be given a little bit of a regress to pull out of your driveway. Whoever's going down there, they just got to get down there immediately. It's extremely dangerous. It's extremely dangerous. So, I mean, we've talked a lot about plan, but the traffic, you know, has to be taken into consideration from a safety perspective.
See, this is where you don't want to do a traffic study, but traffic study might show that it's not you that's causing the problem.
Say that again?
Yeah. I'm speaking to the applicant, and I'm saying that a traffic study would show where the car counts are coming from and what they're doing, and it might show that the movements in and out of the club aren't the problem. So they want to forego that, so we have to make some assumptions about where this is going if we decide to waive that.
And again, I don't mean to imply it's just the club. I mean, what I'm saying is maybe some of these changes might impact that safety, but
right, and
I agree with you, it's not just the club.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I think the safety issue, and I do believe there's a concern there, is all about sight lines and sort of odd movements that happen. Because you drive through there, you're trying to pay attention to make sure you don't hit a golfer, and then you've got people turning. And then you've got a very slight little odd S-turn, S-curve while you're going through there, and it narrows down. So there's as a driver, right, there's a lot to pay attention to right there, and just the added, an added intersection, an added curb cut in there, to me, seems, it's
risky.
Maybe it'll work. It's hard to know, sort of not enough detail. At the moment.
And if I could just add maybe the 30 mile per hour speed limit plays into that as well, because you can get lulled into coming down that grade. You can get lulled into, I've been guilty of it.
Yeah.
You can get lulled in, you know, 30 makes you go 40. And then when you get to those strange turns and those grades,
yeah,
all of a sudden you're in a situation.
Okay. Any other comments? Anything new? Anything different? We do have all of the letters and others that were submitted as well. Yes, sir?
Just ask a question. When are the final plans going to be out for review?
Final plans? I mean, we haven't.
This is not the approved set, correct? This is just half of the bids.
This is the proposed. This is what the applicant has proposed.
Right.
And pending any changes based on what we recommend or what comes up at the next meeting.
Or conservation recommendations?
Or conservation. Conservation might request some changes. I don't know how much it's going to change from this
it's really up to the, you know, this hearing process and the conservation hearing process how much the plan will change.
So what does that do for us neighbors? Is if this is the proposed plan and you approve it, you as a board approve it, then what we said is what? Does it mean anything?
I mean, will there be revised plans to potentially that can be re-reviewed? And
I don't want to sit here and pick apart these plans if you guys are going to make changes and review them and all of that.
Well, the issues raised by these plans allow us to talk to the applicant and say, you need to fix this, we need to change that, or need to consider something. We can only respond to what they've proposed. The biggest issue here is relocating the building, right? Or if the building doesn't get relocated, how are these access points addressed?
And some conditions also require.
Yeah, I don't think you have a choice. I think you have to relocate the building because that will resolve a lot of the issues. If you relocate the building, that will resolve most of the issues, if not all of them. And not only that, it puts it more central with the proposed deck for the pool members and the golfers who run the club, really. So that, to me, is the only option here.
Just to make clear, all we can do is suggest.
No, I
that,
understand
you know,
that.
It's not our club. It's not our project. We raise concerns about particular issues, you know, traffic or noise or stormwater or whatever, and maybe they've heard you and that is an option. Maybe they don't want to consider that and you know they have to come up with other ways to mitigate those issues.
That is fair enough.
TJ Carroll, 260 Grove Street. Could you pull up just the overhead of the course? I'm a good neighbor, so I've never snuck on the course, so I don't know it. So I'm probably the only neighbor, but even in my stepson works in the greens group, so and I still haven't got to play yet, but that's okay. Correct me if I'm wrong. This area up here, isn't there perch ledge up here? I'm just asking. Don't you guys have perch ledge? Rocks?
It looks like ledge.
Yeah.
We haven't.
No, what I'm trying to explain is to my fellow neighbors is if they were to move a clubhouse here, that's a very costly move, and we'd have to deal with blasting. You know, whether it's fractured rock or not, if it's not, they would have to drill and blast, which is going to be a pain in the ass. I don't know the site, so to me, if this is the ninth green, I mean, do you guys have geotech reports on the area? So, I mean, is it even feasible to move this into this area without having to break the budget? I mean, we all want a solution. You guys want a solution, so we should work together on finding a solution. This is what I do. That's why I'm asking the questions, because I pay attention to the money as well as the feasibility of the project. So my question to you is, can we work together to get this? You're demolishing the building, correct? New foundation, new structurals, a whole nine yards, footings, whole nine yards, finished lower level. All right, so I understand going to the same spot. You don't have to remove any subsoil, roughly. You demolish your old foundation, you twist it, you build a new one. Save money, I get it. Is there a possibility, since you are getting rid of the entire structure, of moving it more towards the ninth? You know, your first tee is here, correct? Your ninth is here. It seems to me you have a great landing right in the middle. This is my first view at it. I haven't had a chance to look at the drawings, really. That's my only question. Now, if you do stick with the original plan, my main question was, you got the grease trap in the street. Are they explosion covers? Because I don't want to smell that crap. I would make sure of it. I don't like the sight lines of the dumpster that are going to be on the street. I understand I've watched your architecturals with the logistics. It makes sense to put it there. You don't want it up in the handicap area. You got the area out back. It sucks for us, though. It really does. In order to block that in, the trucks aren't going to be able to get in. I mean, there's got to be a little bit of compromise between the two. You know, if there's something that can be done to alleviate that those sight lines, it would be appreciated. All in all, I mean, if we can shift this up, as to you, you guys did a great job with the rain gardens. I feel like I'm doing a job at MIT. I don't see those very much. Instead of, you answered the question about the ridge line. You had your ridge line up in the parking lot, everything's sheeting off. Trench drain down at the bottom. You know, whether, I don't know what the elevations, I didn't see the grading and drainage plan. I don't know if the elevations of the rain garden are, but if it could work, keep it out of the road. Because we already have issues with the drainage. The town just put a leaching basin directly in front of my house, right over my sewer line, where all my water is. So it's kind of leach right into my basement. But I didn't want to hear my testimony on that. So when my house floods, I'll find out. But, you know, if we could work, you guys are neighbors, we're neighbors. I moved into the situation. I really don't have a place to pitch. You know what I mean? I know that. I hear the swimmers and this and all that all the time. It is what it is. I moved there. Other than that, it's quiet. But like DJ said, you can't say enough about the traffic. It's to the point where I'm going to go drill my own speed bumps into the street, or I'm going to saw cut and put my own speed bumps on the street.
Oh,
God forbid my daughter gets
something
hit.
Worse.
Because
no, that's
I'm telling you right now.
Tragic.
I mean, I'll grab a load of hot top and do it myself. Reading is atrocious with their water and sewer work. If you drive down Grove Street, if I ever did that in the city, we would be blackballed. Thrown out. Boston, Cambridge, Somerville, anywhere outside of Reading, thrown out of the city. Never to work there again. Atrocious. Let me just say that right now. Awful.
It certainly was today.
Huh?
It certainly was today.
And that's where they're paved. You should have seen it before. You think that's bad.
Okay.
There's, as you can see, there's more concern with us about the construction as well.
Sir,
I mean,
you're supposed to be addressing the board.
Oh, I apologize. Well, I'm trying to work with these people. I'm in the business. I don't want to shut down a job. I mean, I think we should all work together and come into a resolution rather than, you know, at odds about you do this and do that, you know. So those are our concerns. I would just try to keep the water back out of the street. We're just solving the water problem now to keep from the houses flooding out. So if we can throw a trench drain down at the bottom, catch the sheet in water, bingo, perfect, you did that. Worry about the dumb stuff, and if we can, you know, maybe check out some borings or some geotech reports, see if it's even feasible to, you know, I understand the cost implications of it, but if we could work together on a solution, that would be great.
Thank you.
Okay.
Nice.
I think we've heard a good series of concerns, and we're going to continue this hearing to when?
Do you want to ask for anything?
Yeah, we do. We want to make a list of that and get it to you and have them look at it. We want to come up with a list right now.
From a timing standpoint, probably tomorrow is better, but from telling the neighbors when the next meeting is, now is better. So.
We'll have to pick the date for the meeting. We are continuing it, so we know when that's going to be.
We have the letter from the conservation.
When's conservation? When's your next conservation meeting?
Not this upcoming Wednesday, the next Wednesday, whatever date that is.
23rd.
Which I was going to probably continue anyways because I want to resolve with this board before I resolve with them. I don't want to close a hearing with conservation, then still have open issues with CPDC, then have to reopen a hearing with conservation. I do need to do some soil testing out there for drainage as well. The engineering department's going to oversee that.
Don't you want to get feedback from them on the new drainage design?
Are you going to go to that meeting and then continue, or just continue and not go to the meeting?
Typically, I have to have materials in 1 week prior to a hearing. That would be this Wednesday. We haven't even done the soil testing yet. So I don't think I'll have the materials together for conservation in time.
Okay. When's our next available?
So, you have pretty full agendas on the 28th and the 11th, so the next one after that would be 25th, September 25th.
That's a month.
You could squeeze it on the 11th.
That's what I was going to ask. If you could squeeze us in on the 11th, that would give us time to talk about what we heard tonight, see what we want to do, and come back with our best plan.
What else is on the 11th?
Downtown Smart Growth District project and a special permit for a home occupation.
All right. I'll do the 11th.
Move that the CPDC continues the public hearing for a site plan review of the project at 292-288 Grove Street until Monday, September 11th at 8 o'clock.
Wait a sec. Have to be at least 8:30.
8:30.
Probably more like 9.
We'll notice it at 8:30 then. We'll notice it at 8:30.
Yeah, I'll notice it at 8:30.
Somebody pulls out.
Right.
And you
sending a notice out?
No, there is no additional notice.
Okay.
So
what time
you
would
can
it be?
Always follow up with me or go on the website. But this is going to be 8:30 on September 11th.
All in favor?
Okay,
who seconded?
Okay, John. So as Julie said, there won't be a notice for that. It's posted on the website now. We'll get you a list of some things in case we can communicate it well.
Great. Thank you for your time. We appreciate it. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
house, there's two houses right there.
Yeah.
That's where you are.
Okay.
See, you're the fifth house here. Not curve. You have cross. This cross is us. Nice couple, Dave, Jimmy, and one little girl.
How would she? Oh, okay.
Okay, next up is a public hearing for definitive subdivision plan, Barton Estates, 4854 Franklin Street.
Notice is hereby given that pursuant to Mass General Law, Chapter 41, Section 41T and Section 6.2.1 of the Reading Subdivision Regulations, the Community Planning and Development Commission will hold a public hearing on Monday, August 14th, 2017 at 8:30 or something like that in the Selectmen's Meeting Room at Reading Town Hall, 16 Lowell Street, to consider the application for a six-lot definitive subdivision submitted by SNL Homes LLC on behalf of SNL Homes LLC and Robert C. and Claire V. Smithney for land located at 48 to 54 Franklin Street, Assessor's Map 52, lots 25 and 24 in Reading, Massachusetts. A copy of the application and associated plans are available in to the public in the Public Services Department, Town Hall, Monday, Wednesday, Thursday, 7:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m., and Tuesday from 7:30 a.m. to 7 p.m.
Thanks. Julie, anything from you?
No, jump right in.
Okay.
Okay, good evening. My name is Philip Christensen, engineer for the developers SNL Homes. As you mentioned, this is on two parcels of land at 48 and 54 Franklin Street. It combines about 6 acres. We're proposing is a 300-foot long roadway and 6 building lots. Four of the lots will have 120 feet of frontage and approximately 20,000 square feet is allowed by zoning. The two lots in the back are large, basically because they're mostly wetlands in the back. If you go to the next slide. So here you see the way the lotting is proposed. As I mentioned, those lots 1, 2, 5, and 6 are meet the zoning requirements, and the rest of the property in the back, which gets close to Eastway, which you could notice on that initial locus plan. But the lots in the back are larger, and that's basically because it's mostly wetland. Go to the next slide, please. And this is an existing conditions plan. This property originally had two houses on number 48 and one house, which is still occupied on lot 50, on 54 Franklin Street. There's a wetland right through here, and that's the 100-foot line from the wetland. And we have the trees marked on that plan as required by the regulations. Next slide, please. And this is what we propose, is a 300-foot long cul-de-sac with the homes shown in these squares. Homes are no closer than the 35 feet, which is conservation's restriction. The roadway itself, what we're proposing to do, and this is you want to call a controversial part of the project, is we're proposing to do a low-impact development design on the project as opposed to standard subdivision design. As you know, your subdivision regulations call for a 30-foot wide road and sidewalks each side. What we're proposing is 24 feet of pavement, 3-foot shoulders made out of stone dust, and a sidewalk one side. And rather than hard catch basin drainage design, what we're proposing is to let the water just drain off the roads into these infiltration areas. Here's an As you know, the state's pushing the stormwater regulations on everything, and this particular piece of property is just sand, sand and gravel. We did a double ring infiltrometer test on the soil here. We got a rate of 120 inches per hour. That's the rate at which the water goes into ground. So while that's very good in terms of an infiltration design for drainage, it's also very difficult to meet stormwater standards on a site that's sandy. Because anytime you put pavement on it or impervious surfaces, you really increase the rate of runoff dramatically. So rather than fight that, you know, one way to do it, you design the road the way the planning board standards are, put a big detention pond down the end, end down here, and then collect all the water drainage from the detention pond and then let it discharge towards the wetland. With the system we're proposing here, the water doesn't drain down to the road, to the end of the road, but just drains to these low points on the side of the road, and then it's allowed to infiltrate into the ground, which it does naturally now. So with that, we would ask for waivers on the roadway width, sidewalk one side, and elimination of curbing and the catch basins as well. We are proposing to bring in water. There's a water main on Franklin Street. We'll bring the water line to the end with a hydrant here. And the drainage, we take, as I said, the drainage will be just go to the sides. And the sewer, there's a sewer here which is relatively shallow. So we can bring it up to approximately this location. We can't get it any farther than that. So the first four lots would have public sewer by gravity. These two lots would need pump systems from the houses up to the sewer here. If you could just scroll through the next, we can look at the, that's just the utility plan. Go to the next one. This is the roadway profile. You can see the existing grade is this line, and the proposed grade is this heavier line right here. Water line is shown here. There's the sewer. It's relatively balanced. I think we maybe have 750 yards of fill coming out of the property, maybe about 670 yards of materials coming in from the roadway itself, for the roadway base and the asphalt. And this is designed too by subdivision standards, with a sloping down from Franklin Street into the property, and the vertical curves provided here meet the standard. Next slide. That's just a little bit of detail on the infiltration system. But let's go to the next one. Just wanted to get the road. Oh, this is sedimentation erosion control. Just wanted the roadway cross section. I think that's on the last sheet.
There it is.
So here's the cross section of the road. The structure of the road is as required by the rules, you know, 12-inch gravel base, 4 inches of asphalt, binder, top course, two layers of top. And what we propose here is a 3-foot shoulder, so you will have 30 feet of drivable surface, but only 24 feet of asphalt, 3 feet of dense graded stone on either side, and, well, sometimes it's known as lid pack or whatever. And then drop down from that at a 3-to-1 slope to a swale, which is where the infiltration areas would be, and then a sidewalk one side rather than two. But the layout is still 60 feet as required by the rules and regulations. The cul-de-sac is 60-foot diameter with a pavement diameter of 50 feet, a radius of 50 feet is required by the regulations. That's just a brief summary of what we're doing. We'd like to get some feedback from the board with regard to these, this type of design for the project.
Questions from the board?
Well, this is the, I mean, not too long ago we were involved with the stormwater management compliance for the state law. which I think kicks in because this would be more than an acre of disturbed property. I don't remember offhand what the impact of that is.
We do have to file with EPA. Anytime you disturb more than an acre of land, you have to file a notice of intent with them. And they look at stormwater management and the stormwater management forms in terms of suspended solids removal, rate of runoff, all that sort of stuff is required.
So you are aware of the constraints and are compliant with those? Or?
Yes, and then also the state regulations with respect to conservation, and because the very end of this cul-de-sac is within the wetlands jurisdiction, the wetlands regulation requires stormwater management as well, and there's 10 different standards you have to meet. That paperwork was included in the package we provided.
Okay.
And we do meet all of that, but on this side, I think the best way to do it is with infiltration.
What's going to keep the roadway edge from falling apart? Because I live on South Street, and there are no curbs. And the water can't get to the catch basins because the edges are just falling apart.
Well, I guess there's two things here. One is we're not proposing catch basins.
I understand, you want to get the water to the swale, and I assume are you at some point going to convey this roadway over to the town?
Yes.
Okay, well, the town's going to have to maintain it.
Right. Well, I tell you, I live in West Newbury. I was on the road committee there. And West Newbury, we don't have curbs anywhere, except if there's a steep hill. Our roadways are 20 feet wide, and the edges don't break up. I mean, if you allow the shoulders to get in bad shape, the edges can break up. But we have roads in town that have been that way for a long time, no problem with it. And it's just, most of the roads are just swales alongside it. If you're familiar with New Hampshire regulations, New Hampshire hasn't used anything but swales for 50 years.
Longer than that.
Yeah, they just don't have any, most of the towns don't have any requirements for catch basins and curbs. So it's not an absolute necessity. I think when you're in more densely developed areas, yes, you need it, but the curb is more a separation between the sidewalk and the vehicles.
Don't get me wrong, I'm in favor of the low-impact design and reducing the roadway width from our standard. We've done that several times now.
Right.
I'm just concerned a little bit that if we go down to 24 feet and we're actually going to drive on that 3-foot shoulder, what's that going to cause it to fall apart?
Well, you wouldn't drive on it, but it's there for people to pull over and park if they want to. But you're driving on the, ordinarily lanes are 12 feet, 11 to 12 feet, depending on which standard you use. You look at Federal Highway Administration, they recommend 11 to 12-foot lanes on highways. So you have a 24-foot road on a 6-lot subdivision. It doesn't get a lot of use, right? You have 12 feet per lane. It's not unreasonable. As I said, in the town I live in, we have 20-foot wide roads, and no problem.
And that's until someone parks there and you need to go around.
What?
Well, until someone parks and then...
We'll take public comments in a second.
Oh, okay.
Your concerns there? John?
I guess it doesn't seem to me like the feedback that we got from the town engineer is in favor of this type of street development. That's not entirely surprising, but the fact that this road then has to be turned over to the town and they need to maintain it, I would want more positive feedback from them than to stick them with this and the responsibilities for long-term maintenance. As Nick said, we have allowed the reduction in the width of roadways, but then with a more standard drainage system. We've done the other thing where we've allowed more of a low impact drainage system, but not necessarily eliminating curbs and doing other stuff like the rain garden that was mentioned in the application that was before you. I guess I would have concern 24 feet with soft shoulders. These look to be like big houses, and they look like there's some pretty small driveways. So my guess is that there's going to be cars parked on the roadway, and not that you can't get around it, but they are going to park on that soft shoulder. And I think that I would want better feedback from engineering than the feedback that we got right now, which is no. It's not their decision, it's our decision, but I'd want a little bit different feedback.
Yeah, something in between. I mean, if you had the curbs, we could still get to the swale somehow. Boxes somewhere and other cuts.
Yeah.
The tree boxes on west of West
Randall Road.
I know engineering's been very busy. They've been doing a lot of work, but can you get us together with them, give direction so that we can get a meeting together to or at least request them to meet with us so we can possibly a balance between the two?
Well, you can meet with them on your own, but it's the question whether they would.
Just
one or two
encourage.
Members here?
No, no. Just that
okay.
They would encourage the engineering.
I mean, have
line.
You reached out to Ryan?
I didn't before this.
Yeah.
They didn't have time to meet with us.
Right.
I know they're busy.
I know Ryan was on vacation for 2 weeks too, so they've been a little understaffed. But yes, I can try to move that along.
Okay. Good.
And then I can't quite. I guess one of the big issues always with reducing pavement width on a cul-de-sac is the actual radius, both outside and inside radius of so that the fire trucks can swing around the circle. I don't recall off the top of my head of what those numbers.
45 radius is the number they need inside.
45.
Yeah, we have 50.
Yeah. All right.
So we held the outside radius on this. It's what you do in the interior. I don't think your standard asks for all of that to be paved, do you? I don't remember. I think you usually have an island, right? So this is a design that most that I've used in other towns, and it's the fire departments are okay with it.
Yeah.
You said this is 50 outside. Right?
50 outside.
They want 45 outside.
At minimum, right?
Right.
Yeah, looks like the bulb is right. Anything else, Karen?
Good for now.
Okay. Well, I'm curious on the plan. The rounded rectangular lines, are those contour lines indicating that the...
In through here?
No, around the house sites.
Yeah, because the house has to be built up. Because we have to do a test pit at each house to show where the water table is. And based on that water table elevation, we set the basement floor, which has to be 2 feet higher. So these being 1 foot contours, usually you're looking at 2 foot contours, but the houses have to be built up to be above that groundwater.
Okay. So you're talking about a yard slope of 4 feet on the
this is
ones
roughly
closer to
3 feet right here,
yeah,
right?
Okay.
On this one. Yeah. But it's no steep. The steepest is 3-to-1 slope.
Okay.
Comments from the public?
Can you just speak to the sidewalks?
I'm sorry, could you just give us your name, please?
June Ewing on Partridge. I'm just interested about the frontage on Franklin and,
accessibility to sidewalks, and is there anything there, or there's, because there are no sidewalks on that side of Franklin, and it's been an issue with the towns, and they've just now decided to plow that in the winter. The sidewalk now, the sidewalk plow now comes across Franklin because of Wood End School, but that's only been changed in the last 18 months. So I'm curious on this other side, where there are no sidewalks of any kind, and there's a number of houses down that way.
If there's no sidewalks, I assume you're not putting a sidewalk in.
Not on Franklin.
It wouldn't go anywhere.
It's not proposed.
Is that anything on our complete streets list?
I don't think so. I'd have to check.
It's not unusual that it's only on one side. I mean, part of Franklin, or a good part of Franklin, is that way. It's just the question of getting across. I know up at Kirchin, they had to put a crosswalk and make some other types of arrangements for people to be able to get out and walk their dogs, and just accessibility going across. This is just a concern.
Okay.
Not that it needs to be changed that you put sidewalks in, but it's, Franklin's tough to walk on.
I'm Richard Gomez. I live on 62 Franklin Street. And getting my mail is a tough time because cars almost hit me. When I shovel in the winter time, cars come so close that I think I'm taking the paint off their car. And how's this proposal going to affect my house?
What was your address again?
62 Franklin. I'm on a butter. As it is, I'm handicapped, and I think I need a handicap sign. One thing, because cars do come close to my mailbox. I'm afraid at times to get out there.
I'll do this from home, FYI.
There's no sidewalk. No curbs. The traffic's bad enough as it is. They raced through that street like it was a highway.
Yeah, I'd say relative to the volume of traffic that's on that street, I don't know that this subdivision will make an impact.
You don't think so? Be more people. There's six more houses, more people, more driving.
Understood.
Three more.
I live there. I pay taxes.
That's 62, Julie? Has that lot been cleared? It's been cleared, right?
48 has,
yeah.
Right?
Okay.
Not 52.
Yes, sir.
Richard Corey, 32 Eastway. They had two different sort of varieties of maps that were up there. One showed the position of the houses, and the other one showed the lots, and I could see where my property was, but I didn't see exactly, like, if there was one where you could see the house and also see my property line. So I just kind of wanted to get a sense for, so there, I'm at 32, which is, you see that little notch basically at the,
yep,
the bottom end, so that's kind of my property right there. So I just want to get a sense for where the house would be situated, and like how far from the stream would the, I'm just trying to
wonder. The houses are right here.
There's a brook down there.
So they're close to it.
And with the, I guess rules are conservation area, how far back could, the trees be cut down and that sort of thing. So that's really my primary concern, I guess.
When does your hearing of conservation open? 23rd. Have you received a notice?
Yes, we did, yes. That's been our discussion for there.
Okay.
Yeah. But just so you know, you can't cut down anything within 100 feet of the wetlands without going to conservation to get approval.
100 feet of the wetlands.
Is that the bluff, that black line?
Yeah.
The lot three mark, is that considered the perimeter?
No, that's a wet, that's a stream, right?
No, it's a black line above it, where underneath.
Little finger?
Yeah.
Yeah. Above, go on.
That, right underneath lot three, where it says lot three, that line underneath, right there, right there.
That's probably a little close to the wetland.
The wet, the wetland line is really, really approximately in here.
If you go to sheet seven.
From is the cul-de-sac, so as I said, the houses are up in here.
Okay.
And the work won't go beyond this point, basically, which is going to be 450 feet probably from the end of the property.
Okay.
We have been asked by conservation to put a, an easement here for access, for people to walk to get through other conservation land.
I don't think we can do that.
Hasn't been resolved.
Can't do that with us.
That's our property, right?
Yeah, we can only do it on our property.
We own 20 Eastway.
Which is with, in front of that.
Yeah.
So you can't put any, you can do what you want with an easement, but you're not going to have access, because we own the property.
Understood.
Right.
Yeah, they could only do what's on their property.
Right, but they can't promise access from Eastway, because we own the property.
Right.
No, you cannot.
That's correct.
That's correct. Yes, ma'am.
I'm Nancy Cole, I live at the corner of 607 Pearl Street, which is right where Franklin, okay? And I have two concerns of the six waivers that were listed on the application. Both of them concern the things that we cannot replace. One are people because of the traffic. And I talked to the police department this afternoon and requested, and I will fill out tomorrow, a request for the number of traffic accidents between Haverhill and Main Street down Franklin, because I think we need that piece of information. And I don't know, I only know through my personal observation of how many accidents there are, some of which we never even called the police about. One occurred Thursday morning, I have my pajamas underneath heavy clothes because it's snowing and I'm putting trash out for pickup. I look out and there's a car slid off, a young woman. Two of my neighbors, Barry and Bob, are trying to push her, but it's going to work time. And I go, I don't want to be out here in the morning, I'm out here to put the trash out, right? So, but they're, in 2-3 minutes, they're going to have her going, but everybody's getting restless and people are speeding around. So I go down and direct traffic, okay, for 2 or 3 minutes. That accident was never reported, they got her back on the road, she was going. Another was just 2 months ago, a man pulls off, they cut the corner from Franklin going south towards, you know, down Pearl. And they come across, all the way across on the other line, okay? A man pulled in there, stopped. I said, are you okay? I thought maybe he was having, you know, medical problem. He'd run out of gasoline, he wasn't from around here. My husband gets gasoline, puts it in. There's not time to call the police, we've got to get him out of there before somebody whips in and gets hurt. Those of us who live there go through this many, many, many times. And that's not even talking about the people who break down, the police that are called, because there are accidents. So we need the evidence, first of all, what is the, what are the number of accidents in that? Very short. The second is because the traffic is going to increase. I stare out at Franklin as I wash dishes and cook. That means I'm staring out that window 5:30 in the morning, 10:30 at night, whenever, because we have a lot of people in and out. There are people who run all the time, which is fantastic.
Bicycles.
Bicycles, people with pushing their baby strollers. And if I'm out there, I tell them to get up in the yard because I'm afraid somebody's going to get hit as they whip around. So I'm very concerned about that. And the other part deals with, you all remember the snows of 2015? We all know them, right?
Nasty.
Well, the town, and it was fine, we had to put the snow somewhere. In the corner of my lot was a mountain of snow. Okay, I couldn't see to the right.
You can't.
So I had to pull out, make sure no one was coming from the left so I could get out far enough so that the semis that come down wouldn't hit me. So the biggest problem is, where's the snow gonna go for this six, you know, and my understanding is this is an affinity. I'm just a definitive subdivision, so we're gonna find out tonight. This is a term that's new to me. This isn't preliminary?
It's not preliminary, it's definitive, but it doesn't have to be approved tonight. It just means that once it is approved, they can construct from it.
So we don't have to come, will we have another chance when we see? This is me learning new terms, so bear with me. This is not my area of expertise. All right, so I'm very concerned, where are we gonna put that snow? Because I would like to think we're not gonna have another 2015, but this is New England. So we're gonna have it. So where's the snow? Because when you look at those three on either side of that, where's that snow gonna go? Okay? I see the houses, I don't see the place to put the snow there. So is that gonna create another blind spot between Haverhill? Okay? So we have children who ride their bikes, which is wonderful. We have people pushing strollers. Walking their dogs. It's a very friendly, mobile place. We have people going to the cemetery. But we're gonna replace two of the three houses, I think, were the houses I never saw until the trees were taken down. Mm. Okay, and I don't know, I've contacted two of my neighbors who've lived there for decades to get back to me, okay, about the people who lived in those two houses and how many vehicles did the lady drive. Okay, I don't even know who lived in those two houses. So replacing six new homes with active families, we're going to increase the traffic. What are we going to do about that? It makes no sense to put a stop like that right there. But we've got to think of something together, because if not, we're going to all be attending somebody's funeral.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Phil Vinciguerra, my wife and I own 589 Pearl Street, which is probably in the back corner of that. The scope of this job changed. The gentleman on the top right corner there came to my house and asked me to sign a petition to, he was going to build two homes, one for his daughter, one for mine. I have two girls, I'd do whatever. All of a sudden, we're putting six houses in. I don't understand.
I would never have signed that paper. I would never sign it again for anyone.
So we're not really in tune with this whole scenario.
That's just not right.
I'm not sure
what you signed, but it has,
whatever you signed has no
whatever you signed means nothing to us. So, I mean, in the fact that, there is nothing that you signed that impacted this process.
That's
so we have an application in front of us for a six lot subdivision.
Wait.
I don't, if they made some statements that it was only going to be two houses, that might have been their thinking then. There is nothing that we relied on that said it was only two houses.
And I said that, but he said he was taking them down to rebuild them for himself and his daughter. I'd be concerned with what's proposed now. Is this going to change again? I have concerns when someone changes it once, and then you propose this, then supposedly they're not going to affect the wetlands, and we hope that conservation will protect us from that, because that is... Our backyard is just...
It's the Scottish moors. You can't walk on it.
You can't walk on it. It's so wet.
From me to you, you see.
It's so wet. And that stream...
And that's just going to back up with six houses going in.
That's going to affect us, all of us. It's going to flex.
Well, as I mentioned in the previous hearing, one of the few protections you actually have as a homeowner is against water damage from a development. The state doesn't care about you other than the fact that they don't want that water doing something. So... there's conservation land there, you'll be protected. They can't increase the runoff off that property.
Okay.
But he's already in an LLC, he's protecting his life. Who thinks he's gonna be there in 2 years? If there's a problem.
I wouldn't worry about that. Engineering will look at what they're proposing and it'll either work or it won't work, right? It's math, so it's gotta work or it won't work. It's gotta meet the regulations and they will only approve it if it does. If he shows he's throwing all his water onto your lot, engineering would not approve that.
I have had water from the properties of 54 onto my property. Gets deep. The whole front grass is all probably a foot deep.
Any other comments?
Yep.
Yes, sir.
John Ewing, 17 Partridge Road. So I have several concerns. One, as a taxpayer, I am not in favor of any road that doesn't have curbs because I've seen it too much in Reading where the edge of the roads crumble. Franklin Street was that way at one time when I first moved in. It was horrendous to drive on. It's just a liability that's ongoing, so I have no desire for any type of road like that. My other question is that I do live on Partridge Road. We do have a retention pond. Parsons Road, the other cul-de-sac has a retention pond. Why does this one not have a retention pond? Why are we coming up with this new system that's supposed to be, is it better, is it worse? I don't know, but without curbs and things like that, I don't see it as favorable.
Is there any other,
So my other issue with this particular development is that with respect to the water table, so the water table sounds high. We're elevating the houses to mitigate that, and we've talked about, you can't put water any places and stuff like that, but how are you going to manage the water that's underground that we can't see? There's people on Franklin Street that their house is much higher than my house. I'm in the low on Partridge Road, and I don't have water, thank goodness. But there's people on Franklin Street that are pumping water out of their basements, right? So now we're going to put all these houses on there. Where's that water going to go? Can anybody guarantee me that those people on Franklin Street aren't going to get more water? Or perhaps maybe that water's going to get diverted to the low area where my house is and suddenly I'm going to have a wet basement? How do we manage that?
Are you talking specifically about the people pumping water out of their basements?
I'm talking specifically, how do we manage underground water that could possibly change direction and impact me that has no water, or possibly impact those that currently have water that may have even more water than what they have now? Because I can tell you, when that cemetery went in, no retention pond, one of the first things we had was a massive rainstorm, and my backyard was underwater, and the town had to go in and mitigate.
But that was after the town said that they wouldn't use compost fill, and then they did, and didn't put the drainage in, and we had to come to the town and say, you just did everything you said was against the rule.
So water's a funny thing.
With regard to the groundwater, we are not building the foundations in the groundwater. There's just no way we're affecting the groundwater level in the area. As I said, we had to dig test pits. In the front of the property, the groundwater is down about 9 feet. By the time you get to the back, it's about 42 inches down. So we have to be 2 feet above that for the basement floor and an 8-foot basement. And that's why the houses are up. So we're not building in the groundwater. I don't think even if we did build in the groundwater, it moves the groundwater around, because you're not talking about huge structures that are going to divert groundwater. So the house construction will not affect homes in the area in terms of groundwater. In terms of, he mentioned early on in that the other subdivisions had detention ponds. That was the way we all designed things. That was the direction we had. States pushed us in another direction, and that's try to infiltrate. You're required by regulations now to infiltrate 65% of the impervious surfaces in a project. You have to infiltrate that water. So, and that means it goes in the ground, where it goes now. So we're not introducing any more water in the ground than what presently goes in the ground. What we're trying to do with the design is mimic what nature's doing at present. When you did a detention pond, you didn't really mimic that, because you were diverting the water to the pond to keep it flowing off site at a certain rate, but you weren't allowing it to infiltrate. So what the government now says is, look, the ponds were great in controlling surface water, but it did nothing to replenish the groundwater, which we want to maintain. So we try to develop systems now that have that balance. The runoff rate's pretty much similar to what it is now, and what goes in the ground is similar to what it is now. That's the way the design is. So it's an improvement over the designs that were just detention ponds, which we did 20 years ago.
How close will you come to the brook that's in back of you?
We're more than 100 feet from that little brook.
From the two houses that you took down, there's a brook right here.
No, there isn't. Two houses we took down are, you can see here, there's a small brook here, and the wetland goes to about here. So these houses were not near the brook at all. And that's verified by the conservation.
Are there any other streets in Reading that have this sort of soft shoulder approach?
I just have to correct you. It's not a soft shoulder.
Okay. Well,
dense graded stone is a surface you can actually drive on. It's firm. Well,
so are there any streets that have that?
Sure. We've improved some low impact designs.
There are.
Yeah. Is Sailor Tom's low impact? So Randall Road?
It must be a soft shoulder.
Yeah, more or less.
Sidewalk.
Some traditional because of what was already there.
Yeah,
the walk line.
It's kind of a hybrid.
Yeah. So Randall Road is
parts of it, I think.
64 Lowell is going to be kind of a hybrid too, but it's not constructed yet.
There's a lot more of it going on. And I understand the value of curbs, of course, but the idea that
safety.
We're not building this infrastructure to move water the way it's not supposed to move, you know, pipes and catch basins and all that, rather than just letting it infiltrate.
Yeah.
There's some value to that.
Again, about the safety issue, it's a narrow street. People speed through there. I ain't get close to getting hit, and I'm trying to get mail.
So, I know a couple of times, can you go back to that map, the graphic, the aerial that you have.
The one,
Yeah.
You want me to zoom in?
So, yeah, a little bit. Well, not that much.
Not that much.
So, a number of you, even more, zoom out a little bit more so you can see Franklin. So, I get it. I drive down Franklin. I think probably everyone in town drives down Franklin from time to time because it's the one road to get across from one side of town to the other without getting on 128. It's narrow. It's especially narrow on that south side. And really, the reason why I wanted her to bring this up is you can really see this curve right here and I know it's narrow right in that space. There's some stone walls that are really close to the edge, so you move out into the center, and I'm assuming that this section right in here is the area where there's more. Well, you then have this other funny little, slight little curve right down in there. A lot of streets in Reading were designed, horse and buggy type of stuff, and that's what we have to work with, and I'm sure Franklin was one of those streets.
But you've also allowed the trucks again.
What's that?
And you've allowed the trucks to go through again.
Yeah, that's a different issue, because with this, and I say that because with this subdivision, what we look at, we're not looking, we can't solve all the safety issues on all the adjoining streets in Reading. Right, the answer to that would maybe be, let's not allow trucks in there, or let's widen, let's widen the road a little bit and take out that curve. I don't know if I don't know if anyone really won't want to do that. Put speed bumps. I don't know. There's a gazillion things that we could do.
I don't want to
this.
My spot, right?
None of those are probably very good ideas. Though what we're looking at for this subdivision is what's the impact of these six lots to the safety of the area or the traffic volume. And the reason why, I don't want you to think that we just dismiss that issue, but the truth is that at least from a volume standpoint, it's three additional houses. A residential house generates 4 trips a day, maybe 6 at most. Multiply that by 3, you're talking a dozen trips. You don't notice 12 more cars on that. I mean, I don't know what the traffic volume is on that road, but that's less, I'm gonna guess that that's less than 1%. So from a volume standpoint, that's something that we're not really concerned about from a small subdivision like this. What we do look at is, what's that intersection look at? Does that intersection introduce another conflict point, especially, you know, people brought up pedestrians. How do we make sure that pedestrians get from this side of the south side of the road to the north side of the road in a safe way without getting hit? So I just wanted to make sure that, because it came up a number of times, that we're not ignoring traffic issues. That's one of the main things we end up looking at. But for this particular, actually, when you look all along Franklin Street, this is probably the best place to have that intersection. Maybe down a little bit, so that it's directly across from the cemetery entrance would be better. So that's basically what we're looking at for traffic-related issues.
Okay. Anything else?
Kyle Kashani, 44 Eastway. As far as the groundwater is concerned, the only thing that comes to my mind is that by having a street, driveways, a house, that's more impervious surface where water has to go somewhere. You know, managing all those impervious surfaces. I know a friend of mine who built a house in Reading, and he actually ended up putting in pavers for his driveway. The town required him to put in pavers because they said that there was too much impervious surface on his lot.
He might have been in the Aquifer Protection District, and I'm not sure that this is.
So there's a part of town where we have a aquifer protection district. It's the watershed that goes into the Ipswich River, and we were required to put that those restrictions on. Required. That's longer story than I want to get into,
yeah.
But they're required, and so there are some parts of town that you have to have those rules. This isn't one of them.
All I'm just trying to say is by having all the impervious surfaces, the street, driveway, a house, water will be going in different directions than they are now.
Well, right, so this low-impact design that they were proposing has pervious surfaces to absorb all that water. And what the engineer will do is he'll calculate the impervious surface of the roof and of the roadway, and he'll distribute that to these areas that he's proposing here. All of those can absorb a certain amount of water depending on how it percolates through whatever soil they have there. Those are the kind of things that engineering looks at to make sure that the numbers he's telling them meet the rules. This many inches of water, you know, on a 100-year storm or whatever you're designing for, can be absorbed by all of these areas.
So engineering's going to use the numbers that they provide?
They're going to provide a drainage plan for this development.
Right. But the numbers in terms of rainfall is provided by a paper called TP40, and that's a standard that the state makes you use, and we have to design for 8.6 inches. The 100-year storm is the maximum rate, but we have to design for 2, 10, 50, and 100-year. So you check all of those storms to see if you get
he's not deciding how much rain is going to fall. He has to use the numbers the state gives him to show that his design meets the regulation. An engineer will confirm that. So what we're trying to do is get somewhere between no curbs and this low impact design so that we're all happy that when the town adopts this road, they're happy maintaining it and the drainage system works.
And one more thing to add on to that. The regulations, the state regulations have got become more and more and more and more strict. So something that was, you know better than I how often they change, but certainly something that was built 25 years ago, I don't even know if there were, if they had to meet any sort of stormwater regulations, but it seems like every 7 or 8 years that the state makes them more restrictive. So some of the issues that houses that were built, say, 10 years ago, they wouldn't meet the same standards that they're required to meet now. So it's getting better.
Hey, one more question. There was another slide up there that showed the house lots with some of the setbacks that were there, and one of the lines went through the end of the cul-de-sac.
Site plan and profile. Yeah.
Yeah, zoom in on that one, maybe. I'm not sure exactly. So that shows a dotted line going through the end of the cul-de-sac. I was just wondering what is that line?
It's 100 feet from the wetland. And that's the conservation jurisdiction. Anything within 100 feet of the wetland, so the house on the top is within their jurisdiction in entirety, and the one on the bottom, the line goes through it, but they still regulate that.
Okay. So, and I'm sorry, but I'm unclear on the regulation. So if you're within 100 feet of a wetland, what does that mean?
That means you can't do anything without filing an application with the Conservation Commission.
Okay.
And they have to approve what you do. And the Conservation Commission looks at stormwater management as one of their issues.
So they're going to be looking at both of those houses that are at the end of the cul-de-sac then?
And the roadway, too, because just because it grabs the edge of the road, Conservation wants to look at the whole road.
Right. Okay.
So they won't just restrict it to, 100 square feet of pavement down here. They'll say, well, you're in our jurisdiction. We want to be sure that
the whole
you're not going to flood the wetlands in the back by just letting all the water pour down there.
Right. Okay.
Same thing you're concerned with.
Sure.
And by the way, conservation will also want to know where they store their snow. So that'll come up by that.
Where will the snow be stored?
So we lower the speed limit on Franklin Street.
I'm sorry, what?
Do we lower the speed limit on Franklin Street?
Just drive slower. The Board of Selectmen of the Road Commissioners.
People speed right through there.
So that line that Carlo just pointed out, that was the 100 foot from the wetland. And so the black line, this looks just like it, set back to the right, that's the actual wetland?
Or that's the 35 feet from the wetland.
Oh, 35, okay. That light gray line is the wetland.
Yes.
Tell them what 35 feet.
So the wetland line is the one with the little triangles, those are flags.
Okay.
Wetland flags.
So is that the stream? No,
the stream's further back than that.
The stream is further back.
Yep. Yeah. So that's the wetland on the side of the stream.
Right.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly. Yep.
Okay.
And that 35 foot line is the town's requirement for housing be set back at least 35 feet.
You can't build within 35 feet of the edge of where they decide the wetland is. And that's usually looked at, they look at plants and water levels and other things. And this is the boundary of the wetland.
So so those two houses are outside the 35 foot line.
But
they're within the 100.
Correct.
Exactly. Right.
So that means they can build something in that area, but they need to go through and meet with the Conservation Commission to make sure that all stormwater and
tree clearing
and vegetation all that sort of stuff, snow removal. Where does all that stuff go to?
Thank you for the clarification.
Sure.
So I have a comment, just living in this area. Snow storage is going to be a big issue because the town will put it right in the corner and will cause accidents.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'm the crazy lady that calls the town every time it snows off Pearl Street because I live on the other side and I get it all. Because they put it right in the middle of the damn street with 20-foot piles. Snow storage has to be dealt with because traffic on Franklin Street is increasing. It's just a...
You can't get out.
Yeah. matter of fact, on Franklin Street.
Because there's no place to store it on that.
We need to figure out a way to make this less dangerous.
To push it in and push it out.
There's actually plenty of room to store.
Yeah, it's 100% the town, DPW's fault, or whoever hires us, no contractor, because they are hard on our side of town. You know, I've been fighting Jeff Zager for this for over 10 years.
Okay, well, you'll have to show where you're proposing to put the snow.
On the corner of my driveway.
Unfortunately, it's where the town's gonna put the snow after we're gone.
Well,
that's true, but I think there has to be some agreement with conservation on whether it can go, for example, at the end of the cul-de-sac.
I got you, all right.
Right?
You guys certainly have enough.
Can't be within 100 feet?
I don't know.
I was gonna say, can you push off, because the snow is gonna contain all the chemicals and whatever else.
Can you push it into the conservation?
Can you push it into within the 100-foot setback?
Typically, no.
Yeah.
Technically.
So when they plow, they typically bring it to the side, so they would push it to the side, straight to the end. They turn the plow and they're actually pushing it to the side, they're thinking, oh.
I've been there 12 years and they haven't plowed right yet.
Well, you gotta put it in the cemetery.
They could just see it.
Might not care.
Probably wasn't gonna do.
Right.
Well, your swales are there and you're not supposed to do that.
No, it melts and drains.
Not when it's frozen. Now, when it's cold and hard, then you're not infiltrating, so now what?
What's that? And they just put it in the swales.
They can, yeah.
And they put it in what?
They're deep.
What?
They're, I mean, they're not that deep, but they're,
yeah,
sitting there just waiting for stuff to fill them in.
But as it goes through its thaw and freeze cycles.
Snow actually acts as an insulator, so after that first snowstorm, it stops the frost from going down deeper.
But that top layer that's exposed will go.
Yeah, the water melts right, if you ever watch when the water actually melts right underneath it.
What we're doing with the snow. Any other new issues, concerns?
Is this development considered a PRD?
No.
So do all the houses, I think, what is the regulation with respect to frontage and acreage? Is it 150, half acre, or something like that?
120, 20,000 square feet.
And all of these meet that?
That's, they build the road so that they can create the frontage for the additional lots, yes. They all meet that. Going too fast.
Yeah.
It's because I should do this.
It's 2 of 9.
What piece is 2?
2 of 8.
Is the only, say, non-conforming thing the width of the street, or is that still within?
It's the pavement width.
Our subdivision rules are old, and we've had discussions about how much do you really want to pave? Do you really want to pave this, what is it, 40 feet? Is that our rule?
30 feet.
It's 30 feet. So we're making these giant roads, and you guys are all concerned with water, but asphalt's impervious. So do we really need 30 feet plus shoulders and plus sidewalks on both sides when you do a subdivision that has 2 or 3 or 4 houses? So we're willing to look at alternatives to that right now before we get to rewriting the zoning for that. Something that's less impact to the town, something that's more attractive maybe than just pavement everywhere. So 24 feet is sufficient for a development like that. We're willing to accept that oftentimes. You know, provided the fire truck access, for example, can still work.
Yeah. So Partridge Road, do you know what the width of that is?
It's not on the list. The list on the front.
Just for comparison, because I find that street a good width, even though it was only 7 houses on it. There's sidewalks on both sides.
So now it's right here. So the public says 50-foot right-of-way width with 30-foot width of pavement. And 2 5-foot-wide sidewalks.
So that was 30 feet.
30 feet.
30 feet.
Pretty much standard.
So that's 10 extra feet of width of impervious in areas that are next to conservation lands and wetlands. And all that water has to be dealt with. All of that heat that comes off of those surfaces has to be dealt with.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because we went through all that with that particular development. Every lot had a certain amount of impervious area that they were allowed, and then after that, yes, you had to go to things like pavers and other things so that you didn't go over what your allotment was.
Mm-hmm. We're still talking about safety issues, so.
Yeah, well, safety is not the building community.
So. Yeah, I mean, the safety issue in this neighborhood, if you will, it's going to be Pearl Street, as you all quite know, because Pearl Street is a 50-foot right-of-way, but it's only 24-foot pavement with no sidewalks.
It's not a cut-through like Franklin is.
Well, excuse me, Pearl Street. Pearl Street is how you get to the center of town from there.
Okay, so we've heard traffic and water, and we're not oblivious to that. We're going to continue this hearing. Is there something completely new? Any other new issues? You're doing the 23rd on this one?
September 25th.
Yeah, I mean, we...
Okay, it's 25th, 28th.
Do you want another late night on the 28th?
I know I promised you guys 66-minute meetings, but...
We had a couple that were like 1 minute.
I know, those
are great. In July.
So I'm still good on my average.
So on the 28th, you have the post office redevelopment opening, and then you have public hearing for your rules and regulations. Which could be really quick since you already reviewed them. On the 28th?
You're on the 28th?
Oh, seriously?
September?
No,
August.
Oh, August, yeah.
An associate member? Can we get that associate member?
Yeah, I should be here.
Okay, so if anyone's not going to be, besides John, he needs to know. Because we'll have to reschedule.
Yeah, but it's just getting, yeah, but...
So, do we put this on the 28th? I think your hearing for the regulations could be really quick since you already reviewed them.
Even if post office is here, it's not a one and done, so...
No, not by any stretch. I don't have a civil design yet.
Okay.
What's the September meeting?
There's the 11th, which is full, and then there's the 25th.
Oh.
We have so many projects right now. Crazy time.
Everybody waits till about this time of year to start submitting.
I don't sleep at all the whole fall.
Move that the CPDC continue the public hearing for the definitive subdivision at 4854 Franklin Street until Monday, August 28th at, what, 9 p.m.?
Yeah.
Some of us work in the morning.
Some of us work all day.
Second.
Do you have the date for the Conservation Committee?
It's the 23rd.
The 23rd.
Yeah, next week.
You can come to the town hall every week.
Yeah, see that?
Yeah. All in favor? Okay. So we'll continue to the
28th.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
2 hours.
Thank you.
What time is
it? For conservation, I don't. But you can come on the website. No, we can look at the agenda.
Yeah, I use it on my tracker.
Julie, or call our office tomorrow. Conservation always start at 7, no matter what you ask. We all have, oh, here at 7.
But Chuck might be able to give more of an idea of like what the real...
I do want to drop to that.
But that's good to know.
No, the other way, sorry.
Oh, sorry.
Pearl. How many cats get on Pearl a day?
We have a couple other matters I need. One of them is this, finally, I have the right combination of people to endorse the second rental plan. I've been waiting since the day.
This is the first one when we walk out.
So, you three guys. And date it May 22nd.
Is it two copies?
No, it should be, because you signed one last time, and I think it should be.
Is it just this one sheet?
Yeah, exactly.
Every page on here?
Yeah, you could, right, I signed it.
Every page.
Why I didn't realize it wasn't two sets, because it was so many.
Oh, yeah.
And, yeah.
I'm not really a.
Then what?
You're up relatively, yeah, we're up relatively high.
You're affected.
I was just curious.
I don't think you need to sign, because you weren't here when we did this first time around.
Yep.
So just make sure to put May 22nd, that's the one.
May 22nd.
Yeah.
No, this is that neighbor, shed is this little.
Thank you all for serving.
We thought it was on the way down there.
Yes.
It only works.
Thank you for coming out.
Because you have the rest of conservation, TR.
Nice to see you.
Right, correct?
Yeah, so.
Is that a big metal?
So I guess my, yeah, right.
Big metal.
Comes back, this line goes up over, and then to the left of the shed, it goes like almost 200 feet to a point.
Yeah.
And then comes back on the other side of the shed, and then it kind of goes flares out a little bit. So I'm missing this, the base of the.
Doesn't matter what it was or something.
And then there's minutes, if you guys want to just throw like really, really short.
But it goes back.
Are you looking at the minutes?
You know.
I reviewed the minutes.
Odd shape.
Yeah, it's just odd shape, but you know, it is what it is, I guess.
And those people, that's all that over there.
Yeah.
Have a good one.
Do you have this copy?
Thank you. Yeah, I did. Like very small, like one page, one paragraph kind of thing.
So called the meeting at 7:31, adjourned at 7:32.
No.
There's a June 26th and then July 10th and July 24th.
Can I cheat off you?
I don't think it's cheating when you're not getting graded. Oh, man.
Oh, this one with the tiny, no.
No, it's this.
Okay, Nick.
You said May 22nd. May is 5, right? 5/22.
Imagine if I realized tomorrow. Oh, my God. Three more filings that I haven't even received yet.
Hmm.
This is crazy.
What did you say was coming on? Do we have any other planning info you want to give us? Other business?
Yeah, did the sicko sign get corrected?
Yes.
It looks different.
It's
I noticed
good.
It looks, but I never got by there.
Yeah, they blacked out the background.
So they did.
Any updates on Burger King?
We're in contact with them. No, it's an eyesore.
No, they look like they cut stuff down.
Yeah, we asked them to maintain the property in better condition than they are, but.
Of eyesore. The old Valerie's Bridal Place on the other side of each street.
We're in contact with them too.
Alright, I'm like, really? That lot looks awful.
They might come back with site plan changes.
Really?
Yeah, because that's a good time.
Can you cut the weeds?
Yeah, we've asked them to do that. Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Move that the CPDC approve the minutes for the meeting of June 26, 2017, as presented.
Second. All in favor?
Move that the CPDC approve the minutes for the meeting of July 10th, 2017.
Second. All in favor?
Abstain, I wasn't here.
Okay, abstain. Now, there's something in the parliamentary rules where you can't abstain. Something.
Oh, really? You can vote on minutes even if you weren't there.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, minutes are just...
But you don't have to, but you can.
The only one that was there was Nick, so...
Yeah, exactly. Right.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
oh,
I guess then maybe you do have to.
Move that the CPDC approve the minutes for the meeting of July 24th, 2017.
Second. All in favor?
Thanks for doing that.
Good meetings.
Guys, for showing up to...
Talk to an empty room. Actually, it wasn't empty.
Yeah,
but
I had a lawyer, yeah.
And I
yeah.
think, did you come to one of them? No.
I almost showed up at one. It was
okay.
Late.
Oh.
Oh. So you did come to town hall. Do you want to adjourn?
Yeah.
Move to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?